Indonesia is one of the largest archipelagic countries in the world, with more than 17,000 islands that spread over an area of more than 2 million kilometer squares. Indonesia is host to several unique ecosystems, containing a large number of diverse species. At least 10% of the world's flowering species, which counts to over 25,000 species, flourish in Indonesia. There are also 12% of the world's mammals, 16% of reptiles, 17% of birds, 6% of amphibians, and over 45% of fishes, all of which are parts of the nation's lush biodiversity. In order to preserve its biodiversity, which also contributes hugely to the world, Indonesia has taken significant steps in accordance to the national and global target on biodiversity framework. The government has allocated more than 500 units of protected area spread throughout the country, with the total coverage area of 22 million hectares terrestrial and 20 million marine protected area. Because of its uniqueness and universal values, 6 protected areas are recognized as World Heritage Sites, 16 Biosphere Reserves, 7 Ramsar Sites, and 7 ASEAN Heritage Sites. Many studies and researches has also been conducted to identify plants and animals to assess their potential uses for medicine, food, energy, and biocontrol for a chemical hazard. Some community-driven activities such as ecotourism has also contributed to the effort to preserve Indonesia's biodiversity, which also encouraged cooperation among local stakeholders. The results are heartening. By 2019, Indonesia has been able to increase the population of endemic and priority species. Communities have also enjoyed benefits from these improved environments through ecotourism, environmental services, and other significant conditions, which contribute to their quality of life as a whole. There is little doubt that Indonesia's vast biodiversity plays a hugely significant role in reducing the impacts of climate change. By preserving its biodiversity and its ecosystems, Indonesia can help support the entire planet's sustainability and ensure a better future for all humankind.
Sejarah Fakultas Kehutanan. UGM resmi didirikan pada tanggal 19 Desember 1949 dan merupakan universitas yang bersifat nasional. Selain itu, UGM juga berperan sebagai pengemban Pancasila dan sebagai universitas pembina di Indonesia. Pada saat didirikan, UGM hanya memiliki 6 fakultas dan salah satu di antaranya adalah Fakultas Pertanian. Dalam perkembangan selanjutnya, melalui Surat Keputusan Menteri Perguruan Tinggi dan Ilmu Pengetahuan Nomor 99 tahun 1963, Fakultas Pertanian dan Kehutanan UGM terpisah menjadi 3 fakultas, yaitu Fakultas Pertanian, Fakultas Teknologi Pertanian, dan Fakultas Kehutanan. Dengan demikian, Fakultas Kehutanan UGM secara resmi dinyatakan berdiri pada tanggal 17 Agustus 1963. Dekan pertama Fakultas Kehutanan UGM adalah Profesor Insinyur Sudarwono Harjo Sudiro. Berdasarkan SK Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi, SK Dirjen Dikti Nomor 163 tahun 2007 tentang pengaturan program studi dan surat keputusan rektor nomor 89 tahun 2010 tanggal 1 Februari 2010 mensahkan perubahan keempat program studi di Fakultas Kehutanan menjadi satu dengan nama program studi kehutanan. Program studi kehutanan terdiri dari 4 bagian, yaitu 1. Departemen Manajemen Hutan, 2. Departemen Silvikultur, 3. Departemen Teknologi Hasil Hutan, dan 4. Departemen Konservasi Sumber Daya Hutan. Di Fakultas Kehutanan terdapat Dewan Perwakilan Mahasiswa atau DPM yang berperan sebagai Badan Legislatif Mahasiswa dan Lembaga Eksekutif Mahasiswa atau LEM. Kemudian terdapat 4 himpunan mahasiswa minat, di antaranya yaitu Keluarga Mahasiswa Manajemen Hutan atau KMMH, Himpunan Mahasiswa Budidaya atau HIMABA, Family of Forest Product Technology atau Forestech, dan Family of Forest Conservation atau Forestation. Di samping itu, terdapat Badan Semi Otonom atau BSO yang meliputi Organisasi Pencinta Alam atau Mapala Silva Gama, Komunitas Seni Kehutanan atau KSK, Keluarga Mahasiswa Islam Kehutanan atau KMIK, dan Forestry Study Club atau FSC. Sedangkan International Forestry Student Association atau IFSA dan Keluarga Mahasiswa Kristen Kehutanan atau BONITA termasuk ke dalam non-BSO.
FFI bekerja di Indonesia sejak tahun 1996, yaitu awalnya bersama dengan LIPI untuk melakukan penelitian-penelitian, terutama penelitian terkait dengan harimau Sumatera. Kemudian berkembang, kemudian kita ada kerjasama dengan Kementerian Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, waktu itu Kementerian Kehutanan, terkait dengan pengelolaan spesies-spesies yang dilindungi. Tantangan terbesarnya adalah kata kuncinya sebenarnya kepedulian. Ya, kata kuncinya adalah kepedulian. Kalau semua sudah peduli, maka secara umum sebenarnya pekerjaannya sudah done. Tapi masalahnya itu, bagaimana kita mendorong semua pihak untuk peduli menyelamatkan planet kita ini bersama-sama. Itu tantangan yang paling besar. Kearifan lokal masyarakat juga sangat penting di sana. Jadi di lain pihak kita melihat ada ancaman, tapi di lain pihak juga kita melihat ada kearifan masyarakat untuk menjaga hutannya. Nah, itu yang kita coba untuk dorong untuk dikembangkan di sana. Planet kita ini yang sustain, sustaining the planet, itu jangka panjang paling panjang kita. Jadi itu tujuan jangka panjang keberadaan MFI. Bukan hanya di Indonesia, tapi di dunia.
Selamat pagi kepada Bapak Ibu hadirin sekalian yang saya hormati. Greetings, good morning to everyone watching this live stream on YouTube. It is a great pleasure to welcome you to Symposium 3, Wildlife Ecology Conservation Management International Conference, WEPMIC 2021. I hope everyone is doing well. My name is Christina Yuandari and I'm going to be the MC for today's discussion focusing on human and wildlife conflict including technological challenges in wildlife conflict, mitigation and resolutions, and practical solutions for wildlife relief. This event's going to be divided into two segments. First is abstract presentation session, where we are going to hear abstract presentation from 9 inspirational presenters from all over the world. And then we're going to have expert talks after a break. This session is going to be chaired by the Honorable Mr. Doni Gunayardi, MSc. Mr. Doni currently working as the head of Biodiversity, Fauna, and Flora International Indonesia program from 2016. Mr. Doni took his Master's of Science in School of Anthropology and Conservation, Durrell Institute of Conservation and Ecology, University of Kent. And throughout his career, he's been putting out amazing publications such as Small Carnivore Records from Meru Betiri National Park, East Java, a publication from 2020. Before we start today's abstract presentation, let me read the abstract presentation guidelines. First, each abstract presentation participant is allocated 20 minutes, 12 minutes for presentation, and 8 minutes for Q&A. And participants are limited to 3 questions, which will be selected by the session chair. So without further ado, please welcome Mr. Doni as our chair session for the first segment. Mr. Doni, the time is yours.
Okay. Thank you, Mbak Ayu. Good morning, everyone. So, selamat pagi, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. So, welcome back to the third symposium of the Wildlife Ecology Conservation Management International Conference. I think in these sessions, I would like to say this is the biggest number of the presenters today. So we'll have 9 distinguished guests in here. So hopefully we can stick with the schedule. And I can see that from the abstract presentations today, we have already some presenters here. And I can see that it is very wide topics from Sumatra, Borneo, Kalimantan, Java, Nusa Tenggara, Sulawesi, and of course there is another 2 from Costa Rica. So this is a quite wide regions in terms of the origin of the presentations, and also with the taxa that been discussed. So I can say that this is a part of the prey and the predators, the tiger and the pigs, and also there's presentation from the gibbons, mammals, hornbill, and the reptiles. So I think because this tight schedule, let's start with the first one. I would like to invite Mr. Dr. Rez Sandy Nurfianto, Institute MSc, from the Faculty of Forestry University of Gajah Mada. So his presentation titles will be Population Density Survey of Wild Birded Gibbons, Helobates albibarbis, oh, High Conservation Value Forest Area of Palm Oil Plantation Company, West Kalimantan, Indonesia. So, committee, please give access to Mr. Sandy for the site presentation. So, time is yours, Pak Sandy, for the 12 minutes.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm still waiting for the organizer to make me as co-host so I can present my presentation here. Would I?
Yeah, loud and clear.
Kok nggak mau ini? Ini nggak mau ini, gimana caranya nih?
So you have the access for this one? Wait. Okay.
Udah belum.
Yeah. Okay, we're waiting. I'm sure the connection is still good because I can see your video very well here.
Gimana?
I have a technical problem.
Okay. So the committee can committee have the your slide presentation and so maybe from Mary or but you can start the slide presentation over there. So I think it's too good to have also be prepared if like this part technical problem arise. So I think it's good to have a copy of that for your presentation to the committee. Okay. Any luck? Oh, okay. I think you have the. Okay. Mas Sandy, I think you opened too many slides over there. So that's why. Yeah, okay, got it. Yes, we can see yours. And just make it the full screen and then, yeah. Time is yours. Yeah, we can see here.
Oke, okay, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I would like to present my research entitled Population Density Survey of White Bearded Gibbon or Halobates albibarbis in High Conservation Value Forest Area of Palm Oil Plantation Company in West Kalimantan, Indonesia. This is a collaboration research between Faculty of Forestry UGM, Universitas Gajah Mada PT Citra Borneo Indah. Wah, next. Okay, in the background with white-bearded gibbons or Halobates albibarbis is an endemic species in Borneo the natural distribution you can see in the map that is restricted to West Kalimantan, Central Kalimantan, and South Kalimantan, South Borneo. And this species is medium ape that live in the canopy or arboreal species. So that means the existence of this species is really highly depend on the forested area in its habitat. But the problem is in Indonesia, have a very high rates of deforestation in at least 50 decades, and then it has made Indonesia lost almost a quarter of its former forested area. We can see that in this GIF. This is from C4, yeah, and that. The forested area is highly reduced by oil palm plantation, also pulp wood plantation, and as the result, that the population of white bearded gibbon is become fragmented and use the remaining patch as its habitat, including the high conservation value forest in the palm oil plantation. And the objective of this research is there are three objectives. At first is to estimate the population density, frequency, and distribution of gibbon in PT Sawit Sumber Masarana or SSS, and also to identify the factor that affecting the distribution of gibbon in the PT SSS here, and also to make recommendation for the management of Gibbon in PT SSS. The methods, the location and time, all of the research was conducted in high conservation valley forest, including the riparian area. The riparian area, there are four blocks here. It's called Pondok Duku, and this is Kinambui, and this is east block is Braforangda, and this is west block Braforangda, and this is Tanjung Biru, the block Tanjung Biru, and in this four area, especially this is we also conducted this research using the triangulation method, triangulation focal cone method, and we also employ line transect distance sampling for the riparian area. So the triangulation focal cone is like this. We establish at least three listening posts, like this. And when there are gibbon and it makes sound, then each of the observer in the each listening post will measure the distance, estimate the distance and also the direction of focal cone. So like this. Yeah, and we using three listening posts that are placed parallel, that were placed parallel with a distance between point 400 meters, and observation were conducted between 5 until 10 EM. We use the parallel listening post because in the research, has suggested that the parallel listening post will minimize the bias. And the habit filter measurement, we use a modified protocol sampling, and this is suggested by Noon and Morrison, and to measure habitat features. The habitat feature is, and there are 22 variables, including the canopy cover and the its life form of trees, from the seedling until the trees size, and also the ground coverage, and etc. And we use a generalized linear model or GLM with family binomial to identify the factor affecting the gibbon distribution in the area. And the sampling is like this. So we establish the plot by grid like this, predetermined grid like this, and the plot it was placed in the center, and between and the distance between center of the plot is 400 meters systematically. And the result, at first for density and distribution of kelawat or population in Pondok Duku, we recorded there are 9 solo call, but no group call, only solo call. And then in Kinambui, there are no call during the research. And West Braforangda, we also record six solo calls. And in East Braforangda, we record there are 42 grid calls, and 18 solo call. And in Tanjung Biru, we record at least there are 98 grid call and 43 solo calls. And the direct encounter, we only found in East Braforangda and also in, the direct encounter only in East Braforangda. And the total of calls is 216. And the total of direct encounter is 5 times. And the average number of individual in the group is 2. So that means only we only found only meet or only encountered female and male in the group without any infant or juvenile. And this is the density, the group density estimation, in Tanjung Biru. So because solo calls cannot be used to estimate with using this triangulation method, so we only estimate in Tanjung Biru block and also in East Bravoranda blocks, that the group density estimation is at least two groups, yeah, in Tanjung Biru, and in East Bravoranda there are at least four groups. And this is the distribution. You can see in this map that the triangle, the gray triangle is the listening post, and the blue dot is the location of the gibbons individual, and the red dot is the location of the group of gibbons. So you can see this, that in Pondok Dukun there are there was only individuals, not in group, and also in the east in west Bravoranda, but in here it is, we can see that there are solo and also the group call, and the in Tanjung Biru block, yeah, there were solo call and also group call or grid call, yeah. And factor affecting of given distribution in PTSS, there are five variables, including ground cover. Ground cover, that means the exposed soil, or it's covered by litter and something like that, and the foliage density, and number of seedling, and number of winning, and also number of trees. All of them have a significant of positive significant effect to the for the precision of given. We can see that in the result that the highest effect, the variable that have the strongest effect in the model is number of trees.
Sandy, you have 3 minutes left.
Okay, thank you. Okay, discussion. Okay. And the conclusion, within PTSS, there are four blocks that were habitat for gibbon. At first is West Bravoranda, East Bravoranda, Pondok Duku, and Tanjung Biru, and factor that have a significant effect on the presence of gibbon in the PTSS is ground cover, foliage density, number of seedling, number of winning, and number of trees. Okay, for the recommendation, for long-term survival of the remaining gibbon population, the most important thing that must be conducted immediately is to increase the carrying capacity of the area, including the food, the space, the water, and the cover or shelter. Yeah. And food, by conducting species enrichment, and space by building the corridor between the blocks, because today is a little bit isolated. In the day is little bit isolated, and better generally gibbon meet their needs, water need through the food. So that means it's need to increase the number of fruiting trees, and the cover and shelter is needed by planting unforested location with local species, including food producing species. And monitoring regularly and continuously, yeah, to find the population dynamics of gibbon in that area. And also it is necessary to immediately plant border crops so that the effect of microclimate change, yeah, and the edge effect can be minimized, because mostly on the forest that tropical forest that have been opened, yeah, it will experience the microclimate change that makes the species become deteriorating and then dead, yeah, and die. In order for gibbon conservation activities to run well, a document containing gibbon management guidelines is required, and which is presented in the work plan for gibbon conservation at PTSS. Thank you. This is the other spaces that found in the location, the Presbyteris Rubicunda. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Sandy. Very well presentations. And I'm sure that this is quite interesting for me as well, because honestly, I never see that in the wild, even I was working in West Kalimantan. So for the next one, we would like to ask all the participants, if you have any questions, you can use the Q&A chat room here, or you can raise your hand if you have some another question to the presenters. Okay. Anyone would like to give questions? Okay. While waiting, maybe the committee can help me if there is a questions coming. So my questions to you, I'm sure in the recommendation you mentioned about the carrying capacity, right?
Yes, right.
So how good is the carrying capacity over there when I look at the density, let's say the highest one, 8.53 individuals, right?
Yeah. Some proportion of the Hague Conservation Valley Forest is rubber plantation, ex-rubber plantation. Yeah, so you can imagine that. Okay, although the gibbon also eating young leaves, yeah, but the calorie content of a leaf is very low. So that means for long survivability, I think it's not enough. Yeah, so that's why in this recommendation, I suggested to the management that they have to do species enrichment in the HCV area. It not also fulfill the food requirement, yeah, but also the water requirement for the group of gibbon that inhabit in the HCV area. In the high conservation value forest area.
Okay, thank you, Pak Sandy. I can see another questions here from Mas Ardiantono. So maybe you can read through, but I can read through as well. So great talk, Pak Sandy. Did you compare the density of gibbons in the HCV area versus primary forest? And if any, what is the difference? I think it's good to.
Okay, then. It's really good. It's really good question, actually. Yeah, I have read the literature from Bockelman and some bands. I will read first. Yeah, and that said that the normal distribution, that mean not too high or too low, yeah, distribute the density of the animals of gibbons in the primary forest or undisturbed forest is 2 groups per kilometer square, yeah. And I found that in this area also at least 2 groups in a kilometer square. So it can be considered as a normal density.
Okay. Thanks for the answers. We still have another questions from the attendees here, or anyone who like to ask questions. Still have 3 minutes left.
Yeah. Or my explanation is too clear. So.
As is loud and clear. Anything else? Okay, Mas Ardiantono, please.
Thank you, Pak Sandy. Just maybe easier for me to talk instead of typing the question. I just wondering, like, could you use the data also and analyze it using a distance sampling?
And the distance sampling.
Are you sure you use it? Yeah.
I haven't used a distance sampling for the analysis. So actually, on the land transect, we failed to encounter the gibbon when we are using the line transect, yeah. But maybe actually it can be, we can also use the distance sampling analysis, yeah, for the data, but I have not tried to use it. I also, yeah,
just wondering, like, if you compare triangulation method with distance sampling, how the result would be different or like similar?
Yeah,
I'm maybe, just curious with that.
Thank you for the suggestion, the advice. Yeah, maybe I will try to reanalyze. Because normally it is easier to use to follow the procedure from the literatures and the easiest one that have high reliability to answer the question, the research question.
Okay, so I think the time is up. I'm very sorry here because with this session. I think this is the biggest participants for abstract presentations. So thank you very much, Pak Sandy. This is a very good presentation. And then I think it's good to also like continue question on what will be the status of this gibbons because you mentioned that this is the research into 2019, right?
Yes.
But to see how survive with the population in these rubber plantations.
Yeah.
So,
that's
I think for the next week, Mick, I think you may compare the result from the previous one that you presented today. Yes. Thank you very much, Pak Sandy. And the next one,
welcome.
I would invite the next presenters from Balai Taman Nasional Gunung Merbabu, Mr. Nurpana Sulaksono. So he will be presenting response of medium terrestrial mammals to various types of disturbance in the Gunung Merapi National Park, Indonesia in Java. So, Mr. Nurpana, are you ready?
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Mr. Gunaryadi, Mr. Doni.
Yes.
Okay, I would like to share my presentation.
Yeah, okay. We can see your presentations and we can hear your voice loud and clear. Could you please full screen the presentation? Yeah,
correct. Yes.
Okay, time is yours for 12 minutes, please.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gunaryadi. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests and all participants in this event. On this occasion, I would like to share my presentation. The title is Response of Medium Terrestrial Mammal to Various Types of Disturbance in the Gunung Merapi National Park. And before I share my presentation, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Nurpana Sulaksono, and I work in Gunung Merbabu National Park. Okay. This is the Gunung Merapi location, the location of Gunung Merapi National Park is my research. It located in Central Java Province and Yogyakarta Province. And Gunung Merapi National Park, we know that Gunung Merapi National Park is most active volcano in Indonesia, even in the world. From the 1786 until 2010, we approximately 60 eruption. And the largest eruption occurred at 1878 and 2010, with volcanic explosive index is 4. This is the highest volcanic explosion. And we know that volcanic activity is one of the major natural disturbance that affects of ecological process. And in Gunung Merapi National Park, in the mountain ecosystem of Merapi, not only natural disturbance, but also anthropogenic disturbance also. There are illegal mining activity and grazing harvest activity. And disturbance is an important component in ecological process. The variation of disturbance can affect ecosystem and community structure and functioning of ecosystem. And we define, I take from Hobbs and Wernicke 1992, disturbance defined as a biotic or abiotic, natural or man-made process that can destabilize the natural system at any hierarchical level. And distinguishing the different type of disturbance, I think it is a very critical issue in ecology, in conservation, and in wildlife management. And why I choose mammal in this in my research, because mammal is one of the indicator ecosystem in Gunung Merapi National Park, I think. And research on mammal is very and never be done. So I'm focused in this research is response of medium terrestrial mammal in Gunung Merapi National Park. My objective in the study is to identify the present or absence of medium terrestrial mammal at every disturbance site, and to estimate abundance and diversity of medium terrestrial mammal at the difference of disturbance site. Methods study area in Gunung Merapi National Park. We know that Gunung Merapi National Park is most active volcano, and especially it was surrounded by 71 sub-village, 30 village and 2 sub-district, Sleman, Magelang, Boyolali, and Klaten, and 2 provinsi, through 2 province, especially in special region of Yogyakarta and the Central Java. And because when I was study in Merapi, the status of Merapi is active, so I exclude 3 kilometer radius, 3 kilometer from the top of Mountain Merapi, Merapi Mountain. Okay, this is data and research designs, and I get the data medium terrestrial mammal from the camera trap, and total number of camera trap is 25 unit. I use a Basnel cam type, and distance between camera trap is 500 meters, and I take the research from the July and October 2020, and camera trap I set 20 hours with 3 times shot in one occasion. And then the vegetation data, I divided into 5 class. There are class S with the diameter of bridge height 3 until 8, class A, DBH, 8 until 15, class C, D, E until class F, based on noon 1981. And I using circular plot with the, in every one camera trap, I take 5 plot of a circular plot. So the total of plot is 125 plot. I like this. This is camera trap and the circular plot run in the camera trap position. And I get the imagery data also, like Landsat imagery, TM, ETM, and only, and Landsat only from 2019. And I get from the GLOVIS, and then I get eruption impact map from the Balai Pengkajian Teknologi Kegunungapian in the impact 1994, 1997, 2006, and 2010. And I get the map of Gunung Merapi National Park also from the Taman Nasional Gunung Merapi official, and the map of grazing activity area from the Gunung Merapi National Park also.
You have 5 minutes left, Pak.
Okay, this is the methods. The first, I get a special analysis to mapping and disturbance, and then identification species using the digicam and camera trap air. And then I measuring variable, species diversity, number of species, and relative abundance index. And then a statistic analysis comparing the number of species diversity and abundance using a Mann-Whitney U-test using the PAST 3.22 based on Hammer et al. 2001. And this is the result of the analysis. You can see that this is the variety of type of disturbance maps this one is in the grazing area, and then this one is the mining activity area, and this is the eruption impact 1997 and 1994, and this is the impact of 2010 and 2006. Okay, from the camera trap, I get the more than 698 photo of medium terrestrial mammal, and the camera also capture photo of human local dog, birds, mice, squirrel, and monkey, and that I exclude from this study. And the camera trap capture one species that has a critical endanger. That is M. Manis javanica, Trenggiling. Well, the other has a least concern status. The Trenggiling or Manis javanica is the new finding in Gunung Merapi National Park. And then based on regulation of the Minister of Environment and Forestry of Republic Indonesia, I get four type of animal that have prothetic status. There are Mutes muncak, Bengalensis, javanica, and District javanica. And this is the picture that was I captured from the camera trap. This is Manis javanica, Istrik javanica, Mutes muncak, and Susukrova, and etc. Okay, this is the vegetation structure and composition that was I get in the site. And this is the ERL, ERA, MIN, GRI, UDR, ERL. The meaning is the set impact disturbance from the 1994 and 1997 eruption, and the ERA, the set impact disturbance from the eruption 2010 and 2006, and the mean is the meaning is the mining disturbance, and GRA, the meaning is grazing disturbance, and UDA is the undisturbed disturbance. And the undisturbed disturbance have the highest number of species and the number of species and the diversity. But in the mining disturbance has the low number of species and the low diversity. And we I compare the number of plant species from the undisturbed area with the other site, and the result, the mining disturbance with and the between the mining disturbance and undisturbed disturbance is a difference, what's the meaning, a different significant difference. Okay, number of species and the diversity of species really a significant difference. And then in the relative abundance index, this is the MI, the mean site has the lowest relative abundance index medium terrestrial mammal, and the undisturbed area has the highest number from this, from the number of presence of medium terrestrial mammal and relative abundant index. The undisturbed area have the highest, but in the diversity, undisturbed area have a low diversity, like this, 1.5, and the highest diversity is the set ERL site, 1.9 diversity. This is a very, very interesting result because the undisturbed area have the low diversity. Okay, discussion. Muntes muncak, Hermaphroditus, and Orientalis can adapt to first step because this three type of species can live in the all disturbance, even though the condition are affected by natural or human disturbance. These animals are present because of the availability of food, or because they are just passing through as corridor or for protection from the predator. The existence of sand mining activity in the river channel can cause damage to the function of the river as a wildlife corridor. And Manis javanica and Istis javanica were not found at mean site because they are animals that inhabit burrow or holes, living in holes, so that they require a loose site. And this condition is not found in the mean site, which is composed of rock and sand. And the abundance of Montes Munca and Histix javanica is due to the absence of top predator that prey on this animal. This condition will lead the competition in the use of space and feed. Okay, and this is my theory discussed when the I use idea concept that describe that the relationship between the disturbance and spatial diversity. The diversity in optimal point when the condition of disturbance at the moderate level, and why undisturbed area have the low diversity but a high number of diversity and high the DVD but low in diversity. But in the mean, mean have the low number species and low number of individual and low number of diversity also. And this conclusion, each disturbance has been responded to differently by its by its set. This can be seen from the presence and absence of species, species richness and diversity of species that differ in every site. And human disturbance mining activity have a high impact on ecosystem damage, and the area affected by the eruption 20 years ago shown that it has started restored from the damage. It was indicated by the presence of medium terrestrial mammal animals and has the highest MTM diversity. And this is the recommendation to maintain and protect Mon Merapi National Park from the illegal hunting, illegal logging, and other activity like the illegal mining, restoration and rehabilitation program using native species plan, and to speed up the ecosystem recovery process and make connection of corridor between site operates to ensure that the meta population happen. Okay, I think terima kasih, matur nuwun. This is my presentation. Time is yours, Mr. Abi.
Yeah, thank you, Pak. And I think we have only one question left here because we have only 4.5 minutes for the questions. Do you have any questions for Pak Nur? Anyone? So I can see here in the chat. Okay, from Mas Adi Antono. Is there any hunting activity recorded in the national park, and how it will affect the species? As I saw, some species can be targeted for hunting, like Munca. Can you please answer the questions?
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ardianto. Okay, I will show you that this is the I capture the hunter and the other disturbance, not only natural disturbance like eruption, but the hunter and the wild dog that catch in my camera trap. But actually, I don't. What's the meaning? I don't analyze more about the comparison. Illegal hunting. Illegal hunting with the occurrence of medium terrestrial mammal, but I think that is any comparison maybe because the illegal hunting in Gunung Merapi National Gunung Merapi National Park surrounded by full of settlement and so many local people came to the national park. And not only local people, but the hunter. I think that is the evidence that the hunter in the Gunung Merapi National Park. But the the effects of Hunter on the medium teres mammal, I don't analyze that. So I think that's all, Mr. Doni Gunaryati.
Okay. We still have 2 minutes and 20 seconds. One more question here from Mrs. Arisa. So I would like to ask about the wildlife behavior at the national park. So what about the behavior of wildlife when there is an increase of volcanic activity? And also the other question is, what kind of conservation effort are being carried out in this national park area to the protected endangered species in this volcanic area? Can you answer, please?
Okay. Can you please in the first answer?
Yeah, about the behavior of wildlife during the volcanic activity, if the eruptions begin. So okay. Do you record some of the changing behavior?
Okay, thanks you. That is good question. The behavior of a medium terrestrial mammal when the volcanic active. Yes. I don't find the change of behavior of medium terrestrial mammal because when I take the camera trap from the 2020, it have been volcanic active, but I don't find the change of behaviors. I think that is the medium terrestrial mammal have adaptation with the natural disturbance, I think. So when the natural disturbance happen, they was adapted, yeah, with the natural disturbance. They just move to the other place, but just in Gunung Merapi National Park, not migration in the other place, maybe, and the other pets, maybe.
Okay.
Just in National Park.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm sorry, I have to cut the presentations because the time is out. So the next one, maybe for the Mrs. Rai, Arisa, you may ask Pak Nurpana directly, maybe possible. And thank you very much for the talk today, Pak Nurpana. This is a very, very good, interesting talk. And then I think it's good to, similar to the previous one, there will be a continuous monitoring for the area of Gunung Merapi, of course. And I think it's good to have how the restorations of the area and then the occupations of the some of the key species over there. Thank you very much. And the next one, because this is a very tight session. Next one, I would like to invite Miss Romantina Ezerhitros. Am I right? Just look at for the names. Apologize if I spell it wrong. And then I would like to invite her from University of Samudra. And
yes,
she will be talking on the density estimate of hornbill species of the Ketambe Research Station, Gunung Loser National Park, and local people perception about hornbill. So if you're ready, please give your presentation. We have 12 minutes for the talk and then 8 minutes for the question and answer. So the time is yours.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Romantina Ezerhitorus, at the student of the University Samudra University. I will present you about the study density estimate of hornbill species at Ketambe Research Station, Gunung Loser National Park, and local people perception about hornbill. The background of the study, Sumatra and forest is home to 9 species of hornbill. Many are threatened due to habitat loss and hunting, yet their population status is largely unknown. The existence of local people, the forest is very important, part is in the purpose for hornbill conservation. Local people such as knows any and attitude towards hornbill affect before fire agent to support conservation, hornbill conservation, or vice versa. So the importance, the understanding the condition of the hornbill population, how the local people perception the hornbill, this is research to find out the estimate density of hornbill at the research station Ketambe, Gunung Leuser National Park, and data collection of knowledge and attitude local people in Ketambe village about hornbill. The study area survey transect with a total of 6.78 with a distance edge of the transect in transect 1 780 meter, for transect 2 to 5 is 1500 meter. The method of the hornbill population density is data collection with line transect. The data record is the number of individual or group hornbill, the distance between the position of the hornbill with the position of observation based on direct or indirect observation or sound between transect and hornbill, and coordinate of findings. And then the data analysis distance software. And next, a hornbill plot with tree survey, data collection with light transect, the survey of fruit tree of hornbill feet by calculation of the percent of fruit in the canopy, percent of ripe fruit, and percent of ripe fruit in the canopy. Next, data analysis with multiple linear regression and local community perception with data collection in interview. The survey was using structured interview with two types of question, close and open question. The type close is used to form of record. The open question is used, the type is gender, age, duration of stay in Ketambe, Ketambe village, occupation, and knowledge of hornbill. And next, the data analysis, descriptive and multiple linear regression. The result of the study is number one, density estimate of hornbill. In survey of detection of there are four types of hornbill at the Ketambe research station. All recording are aural or sound detection. The species rhinoceros hornbill is the type of hornbill with the highest detection. Density estimation analysis can be only performed of rhino hornbill species. In the 6.34 of percent kilometers plus minus 23.2% coefficient variation, the Killingen hornbill, crested hornbill, and Julamas have a low number of detection or less than 10. Therefore, analysis for this is three species can be carried out. And next, density for result. Density hornbill density in the study is lower than with previous research in July for September at the research station Ketambe, Ardiantiono et al. 2020. In the study, it's found the detection of which is high in the Killingen and Julangmas species. And next, a result of correlation between hornbill detection and the fruit availability. And the survey where 158 observation of fruit tree from 9 family in Ketambe research station. Comparison between model describing hornbill detection showed that the best model is hornbill detection with fruit present in the canopy because it's a low ice value. However, the effect of fruit on the canopy does have no strong support because with a p-value 0.29 rather than 0.05. And next, about local local precision about hornbill, the comparison between independent variable model, so the best model attitude with egg is the best because the large ice value on independent variable with a p value 0.04 less than 0.05 means are related to attitude towards hornbill. And next conclusion of the study, therefore, for species in detect in Ketamber station is bushy crested hornbill or Anurus galeratus, white corned hornbill berani cornis comatus, and white hornbill Rhinoceros undulatus and Rhinoceros hornbill obscurus rhinoceros. Density estimate of Rhinoceros hornbill or Buceros rhinoceros were 6.34 individual per kilometers. Well, the estimate can be for other species because the low number of detection and the availability of the fruit accompany the hornbill with B value 0.229, but don't have a strong support. And the next, the egg of the respondent affect the attitude towards hornbill a bit with V value 0.04. All the respondent tended to have a low attitude towards hornbill. And next, suggestion research on the estimation of hornbill density and long term fruit have availability to see the population dynamic of hornbill and modification on the interview survey by adding other factor that might influence people attitude towards hornbill. And thank you.
Thank you for you very much, Miss Romantina. So you still have 4 minutes for your presentations. You still have another things to add? No? Okay. If not, then let's start for the questions and sessions. In here, you have around 10 minutes for the questions and answers. So I will set the time for 8 minutes. Maybe it's good to maybe to give the other presenters more time, maybe. So any questions, please put your question in the chat room, or if not, you can raise your hand and then we can ask you directly using this Zoom meeting. You have any questions? Okay, while waiting, I would like to ask maybe. Oh, okay, there's a question, it's very good. Okay, from Badar Johan. Regarding the perceptions of hornbill, what are the efforts made by hornbill observers regarding the issues of hornbill being hunted for the needs of traditional Chinese medicines? Can you elaborate and answer the questions? So I think it's good to have. Okay. Yeah, could you stop the share screen, Ms. Romantin? Yeah. Okay. So can you answer the questions, please?
Oh, okay, thank you, Badar Zohan. Regarding of the perception hornbill or effort made by the hornbill observation regarding issue to traditional Chinese medicine in the survey, don't have a issue about traditional Chinese medicine, but all about hunting to hunting bird.
So you mean there are people hunting this hornbill species, right? Hello, can you hear me?
I heard, but oh my God. Oh, sorry, my connection is
okay. So can you repeat your answers, please?
Okay, in the observe. Okay, wait. the observer of in issue of Ombil is hunted to needs of traditional Chinese medicine in the Ketamba Research Station. I don't have a issue about traditional Chinese traditional Chinese medicine.
Okay, so it means that there are some of the hunting of this one. I cannot hear it clearly. Okay, next one. So, if no questions, you still have 4 minutes. I would like to ask about how is your survey have a low number of detections during the survey? Is there any disturbance during your survey? Ada gangguan selama survei, kenapa deteksinya rendah?
For the study, I don't have about gangguan. It is about the lebih ke buah, pengaruh buah for me.
Okay. The fruit availability of the for the fix or in some, so that's why you have the low number of detections during your survey, right?
Maybe, but okay. But this is research for 2 months. I don't sure, but because this is my suggestion from my study or to long term about the density of Ombil in the research station Ketembe.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Any questions? If not, then the time is up. I would like to thank to Ms. Romantina Ezercitorus for this is a very good research on especially with the hornbill, because it's quite rare on hornbill populations studies. Okay, next one, I would like to invite Mr. Ardiantono. Thank you very much, Ms. Romantica. Mr. Ardiantono from University of Kent, United Kingdom. So he will be presenting prioritizing high risk area of negative human crocodile interactions in Indonesia. So I think it's quite interesting to hear about this. Okay, if you're ready, Mr. Ardiantono, you may start your presentations now.
Thank you.
It's yours for 12 minutes.
Thank you, Master Gun, for the introduction. It's Tiono, by the way. It's okay, it's all right. It's like everyone usually says. Don't know. I will share my screen and we'll see how it goes. Can you see it and
yes.
Hear my voice clearly?
Very good. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
And loud and clear.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So today I would like to share our exciting research about how we could integrate social and ecological information to understand human-crocodile interaction. So when I was a kid, when I was young, I always believed that we human live in harmony with wildlife, like the one in this picture. But growing up, I realized that most of our interaction with wildlife is actually coming in form of human-wildlife conflict, or where the wildlife possess negative impacts towards human, and it could lead into retaliation. Conflict is a challenging issue in conservation because this kind of interaction will keep increasing in the future, especially along with human population growth and expansion. So there's a lot of body of knowledge that's trying to understand about human-wildlife conflict, most of them focusing on big mammals. Very few information on reptiles, especially crocodilians, although this taxon is actually the one that highly involved in conflict with humans. So talking about crocodilians, I bet we all know about saltwater crocodiles, the largest species of crocodilians and also the one species that highly involved in attacks on humans. Indonesia itself, our country, has the highest report of crocodile attacks across the world. There are many reasons for the attacks. Some of them are habitat degradation or destruction, prey depletion, and also human activities. However, when we talk about human and crocodile conflict, we must acknowledge that it is a complex situation. It is involved like social, politic, and also economic aspect of the stakeholder that interact with the crocodile. Also, we know that most of the driver of crocodile attacks are coming from human activities. So it's really important to see human-crocodile conflict as a two-way interaction, where not only saltwater crocodile attacking human, but also how people perceive and react on the crocodiles. So our study trying to understand and integrate social, the human dimension, and ecological, the attack by crocodile information to identify the priority high-risk area for future management. To do that, we will answer these four questions. What is the pattern of the conflict? Where is the hotspot? How people tolerate the crocodiles? And combining all of this information to identify the priority risk area. So for our methodology, we conducted our study within the saltwater crocodile distribution across Indonesia. So we created around 1,000 grids with the size of 50 kilometers. And we collected information of crocodile attacks on human from 10 years period. And most of them are coming from news reporting, so newspaper and online mass media, supplemented by the information from the field survey and also local correspondents. For the analysis, we conducted a Hardel model, which is basically two models integrated into one. So if we have a grid with no reported attacks, we could estimate the probability of attack occurrence. If we have grids with reported attack like this one, so it's account data, we could estimate the predicted number of attack in that area. And for this model, we consider different type of covariate, ranging from habitat covariate, human activities, climate, and also reporting effort. For the social dimension, we measure the public tolerance. So as we all know, conducting social survey across Indonesia is very challenging and it takes a lot of effort. So we use data from the online media reporting for the last 3 years, and we use headline tone, or like the tone of the title of the article, as a proxy for public tolerance. So we have three categories: positive, which actually like the article encouraging the conservation of saltwater crocodiles; neutral, stating the fact as it is; and negative one, which is interesting because they have a sensational news, sensational headline that gives negative perceptions on the crocodile. For example, the one in the Irish Sun, you can see the title. So they have the words like deadliest crocodile, torn to pieces, dead rolls. So this kind of word is kind of like the one, a negative diction that could give like a negative perceptions towards the crocodile. And then we calculate the index of intolerance. So basically using the from 0 to 1 using the following equation. And then when we try to identify the high-risk area, we combine the information from the social dimension, the tolerance, with the ecological information, the attacks of from the crocodile itself. We use two different thresholds, so median for index of intolerance and 1 for estimated count of attacks. So the grids, 1,000 grids, will be divided into 3 categories: low risk, medium, and high risk. And we are interested in high-risk area, which is basically saying that in this grid, we will find a crocodile attack estimated more than once, and also like people there have a lower tolerance toward the crocodile. So how's the result? What we find is like we recorded almost 700 attacks. Almost half of them are fatal, and most of them involve male victims. All of the attacks are occurred when people conducting activities within or near the river. So activity like fishing, self-cleaning, bathing, or working is like are three the most common type of activities during the attack. We also found that crocodile attack increasing over the year, and they are most likely to be higher during the wet season compared to the dry season. And when we're talking about the attack hotspot, could see, the yellow point, the yellow dot is the location of reported attacks that we have collected before, and the red grids are actually the grids with the estimated number of attack above one based on the output of the Hardel model. So we would say the red grid as the attack hotspot area. And across Indonesia, we could see the attack hotspots are distributed across Sumatra, Eastern Kalimantan, and Central Indonesia. In more detail, we found that the attacks are higher actually in area where you have like a disturbed habitat, so lower forest biomass, have a low human density, mostly in a rural area, because when we're talking about the urban area with high human density, usually the crocodile population already extinct or has been translocated. And interestingly, we found that the attack also like higher in area with large cellular network. It means that people who have access to the cellular network are more likely to report the attacks to the authority and then to the media mass, to the mass media, which has become the source of our data. How about the intolerance map? So we use the index of intolerance per province. So we found that Riau province, the red one, is the province with the highest index of intolerance, followed by Bangka Belitung and Kalimantan Timur, and Aceh and Kalimantan Selatan. So then we combine this information, the attack hotspot with tolerance map using the quadrant approach, and we found that actually the hotspot, the high-risk area of human-crocodile conflict, is distributed in 5 provinces in the eastern Sumatra and 1 province in eastern Kalimantan. So we will discuss more about our last finding about the high-risk area that we just have identified. So, for example, like this study, what we like to say is we're trying to see human-crocodile conflict as a two-way interaction. So crocodile attacks on human, which represent the ecological aspect of the interaction, and how people tolerate the crocodile itself, which represent the social aspect. And all of this data, or most of this data, are coming from media news, like online media or like newspaper. So we would like to highlight the importance of utilizing the already open access and public database, such as media reporting. And what we found, if we use social and ecological information, actually we could have a more targeted approach for future management. For example, if we just focusing on the attack hotspot, the ecological aspect by the crocodile, the attack hotspot are actually distributed not only in Sumatra and Kalimantan, but also in central Indonesia. But when we combine it with tolerance map, we found the high-risk area, the priority for future management, are actually getting narrow into eastern Sumatra and eastern Kalimantan. The question is like, why eastern Sumatra, why eastern Kalimantan? We are talking about two most populous islands after Java, and also like this region have like a very high human density and population growth. So it also will cause like, or will drive like habitat destruction. So mangrove forests, like riparian forests, are mostly degraded in this area. This area also has like a high economic development. So we're talking about the area which like well coverage by cellular networks, so people could easily report about the attacks to the authority and also getting to the mass media. Into Kalimantan, the next island, we all know that Kalimantan Timur is the province that will harbor our new capital city of Republic of Indonesia. And when we're talking about the development of a capital city, it is for sure will attract more people to come in this area and also more economic development. Coincidentally, this area also the high-risk area that we have identified in this study. So the question is like how we could mitigate the future risk of human crocodile conflict. We have 3 recommendations. The first one is how we could protect and restore the habitat. The second one is how we could limit the interaction between people and crocodile. One of them could be the building the fences in areas where people usually utilize the water for their daily activities. Or maybe like the other option would be translocation of problem crocodiles. The last one is like how we could increase the tolerance towards the crocodile One of them could be collaborating with the media, so we could report the cases like using a more objective title or headline, and also more comprehensive reporting about the cases that has been happened. So to close my presentation, I would like to say, like, our study, again, emphasize that our study, it is very important to consider the two side of two-way interaction of human and wildlife. So it's not only the ecological aspect of the species, but how people also see and perceive the animal itself. And we really hope that more study will come in this topic, will be published and will be conducted. And together we will find a way for us to find the ways for us humans to coexist with wildlife in the future. So thank you very much for the attention. Let me stop sharing my screen.
Yeah, thank you. What a nice presentation, and I think it's a very good article in the media next after your talk, especially on the new capital city, right?
Yeah. I hope it doesn't open.
Somebody has to warn the government on this one, honestly. Anyway, so do you have any questions for all the audience here online, or from maybe if you have questions, just raise your hand, and then I think it's very good. Interesting on the presentation from your talk here. Very nice one.
Thank you.
Okay, one question from Pak Sulaksono. Nice presentation. Which one is more aggressive, female or male?
That's quite a tough question, actually. Like, I must say, like, Pak Sulaksono, I'm not the expert. I'm not the crocodile expert. So my other co-author is the expert of crocodile. Mm. They should be the one who answering this question. But what I know is, like, what I found is most of the crocodile attack usually happen during the wet season where the female are nesting their eggs. So when they are like the nesting period, they become much more aggressive, and usually the attacks occur during that time. About the male one, I'm not really sure, but I might try to find it later. Thank you for the question. I just want to make sure. I guess Mas Dogun is freezing. I think, shall I wait for Mas Dogun, or like, can I answer the question right away? Okay, can you hear me? Yeah? Okay, so I'm gonna answer the question from Bu Mari about the crocodile attack because of self-defense. Yeah, there's like some factors that might explain the attack, like some of them is self-defense, so kind of like the nesting female crocodile usually attack when people getting closer to the nest. But also what we found is like crocodile itself can deliberately targeting human as they prey. So in some cases you found that the attacks occurs when people doing their daily activities. So it's kind of like they're already aware that people will come to the river in this spot to, let's say, to do bathing or like to self cleaning of themselves. So there's a lot of factors that could motivate the attack. So self-defense could be targeted, like they see us as a prey, could be also, or simply there's no prey, natural prey, so they're gonna change the prey into humans. Let's just say, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm apologize because suddenly my laptop was shut down.
Yeah.
Changed to my cell phone, and then for my calculation, I think your time is up, and I will say thank you very much, and what a nice presentation here. And then I get, this is very good knowledge for me as well, knowing that the effort for having this information is quite enormous, I can say. Thank you, Pak Adiantono, and I think keep doing the good things. This one, and then,
all right.
And I'm sure that somebody has to warn the government on for the capital city, honestly. Thank you very much.
For the next one, honestly, I have to open my schedule here because it just shut down directly. I'm sorry for this one. Wait a minute. The next presentations will be. So the committee could please help me because I'm just start opening my PDF. Come on. Yeah. Okay, next ones. I will invite Mr. Asim Al-Yoihana Lanusi from PROGRESS, Prakarsa Konservasi Ekologi Regional Sulawesi. He will be talking on lesson learned from community-based conservations to protect threatened yet overlooked wildlife species in Sulawesi, Indonesia. So, Pak Asim, are you ready?
Ya, saya ibu Pak.
Oh, ibu, I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Sorry. I'm very very sorry. So this is Asim. Okay, if you're ready,
yeah, saya, time is yours. Ya, thank you.
12 minutes. 12 minutes.
Saya akan membawakan presentasi dalam bahasa Indonesia.
Oh siap. Okay, ibu ada waktu 12 menit ya bu, jadi nanti. Yeah. Beri saya waktu sekitar beberapa menit untuk men-summary dari presentasi Ibu. Silakan Ibu di presentasi.
Terima kasih, salam lestari. Saya share screen. Oke. Okay. Terima kasih kesempatan yang diberikan oleh WebMeet diberikan kepada PROGRESS, kami Prakarsa Konservasi Ekologi Regional Sulawesi. Saya Asim Aliwehana mewakili PROGRESS. Lembaga kami berkedudukan di Lubanggai, Sulawesi Tengah. Kami bekerja di tingkat tapak. Di sini saya ingin menceritakan perjalanan PROGRESS dalam melakukan upaya konservasi berbasis masyarakat untuk melindungi satwa liar Sulawesi yang terancam namun terabaikan di. Kita ketahui semua bahwa Sulawesi rumah bagi segudang spesies endemik, tapi banyak spesies endemik ini yang belum mendapat perhatian yang cukup dari segi penelitian maupun dalam upaya konservasi. Nah, PROGRESS ingin membantu mengatasi persoalan ini dan turut berkontribusi dalam upaya konservasi di Sulawesi yang sudah berjalan lama. Kami fokus kepada satwa terancam yang kurang terkenal. Mereka ini adalah satwa endemik yang mendapat tekanan sama besarnya dengan satwa lain yang sudah terkenal, baik dari segi perburuan, perdagangan, maupun kehilangan habitat. Sayangnya, karena satwa-satwa ini kurang terkenal, maka masyarakat pun belum mengetahui apa keistimewaan satwa-satwa yang mereka miliki. Kami mengambil bagian untuk memperkenalkan ini. Nah, salah satu kendala juga bahwa distribusi satwa ini berada di luar kawasan yang dilindungi. Nah, ini berarti masyarakat perlu perhatian masyarakat dan untuk mensukseskan upaya konservasi yang dilakukan. Di saat ini PROGRESS menjangkau 3 spesies, yaitu bantiluku, poniki, dan kuskus. Kami memulai dengan pelan di tahun 2018 dan mempelajari kalong atau di sini disebut poniki. Kemudian 2020 mulai dengan banding Sulawesi atau disebut bantiluku. Kemudian di 2021 kami memulai dengan kuskus talaut. Nah, pendekatan kami dua yaitu berbasis masyarakat dan berbasis sains. Nah, berbasis masyarakat ini berbasis masyarakat untuk mengkultivasi rasa kebanggaan terhadap alam Sulawesi dan meningkatkan kapasitas masyarakat untuk perlindungan alam yang berkelanjutan. Yang kedua, berbasis sains. Nah, berbasis sains ini kami tujukan untuk mengisi kekosongan pengetahuan tentang satwa endemik Sulawesi yang tidak populer dan untuk mendukung upaya konservasi yang lebih baik. Ini adalah kegiatan konservasi pertama kami, Kalung Sulawesi atau Acerodon sulawensis di Kecamatan Bualemo, Kabupaten Banggai, Sulawesi Tengah. Bersama pemuda lokal, kami melakukan pemantauan koloni sebanyak 2 kali setiap bulan menggunakan metode perhitungan standar. Hasil pengamatan kami menunjukkan bahwa koloni kalong ini meningkat dari tahun ke tahun. Di tahun 2018, tercatat jumlah koloni itu sebanyak 8.376 individu. Dan di 2021, meningkat menjadi 35.707 dan data populasi musiman yang konsisten kami miliki. Di awal kegiatan, kami melakukan penelitian dan di saat bersamaan juga melakukan pendekatan ke masyarakat. Kami menyadari bahwa masyarakat belum mengetahui keistimewaan poniki ini, sehingga mereka membiarkan perburuan poniki terus terjadi. Lambat laun, kepercayaan terbangun, pelan-pelan masyarakat, terutama nelayan dan anak muda, sampai saat ini masyarakat sadar dan berhenti berburu dan ikut melakukan pengawasan karena telah menyadari pentingnya kehadiran kalong, sehingga terlibat untuk melestarikannya. Setelah hampir 3 tahun, Pulau Mantawalu Daka ini menjadi rumah yang aman untuk poniki-poniki di sekitar di Kecamatan Bualemo. Kami juga melakukan penelitian untuk memahami lebih dalam jasa kalong bagi masyarakat, di antaranya penyubukan durian dan juga jasa penyebaran benih bagi pohon-pohon di hutan Sulawesi dan Bakau. Harapannya informasi ini bisa melengkapi kekosongan pengetahuan tentang pentingnya kalong dan dapat membantu upaya konservasi di kalong di Pulau Sulawesi. Dalam perjalanan kegiatan progres selama 4 tahun ini, kami mempelajari bahwa kunci keberhasilan konservasi adalah pada keberhasilan membangun kepercayaan masyarakat. Bila masyarakat melihat bahwa kegiatan konservasi memberi manfaat bagi mereka, mereka tidak saja akan mendukung, tapi juga ikut terlibat. Kami mengedukasi masyarakat lokal dan memberikan keterampilan penelitian berdasarkan sains, agar selain lebih tahu tentang kekayaan pemberdayaan alam, dan mereka mengetahui betapa istimewanya apa yang mereka punya. Jika mereka merasa lebih memiliki, pastinya mereka akan ikut melestarikan. Kami membantu memberi pemahaman bahwa upaya konservasi dapat bersinergi dengan upaya pembangunan desa dan meningkatkan kesejahteraan masyarakat. Dalam memperkuat hubungan kami dan serta menunjukkan komitmen kami untuk menginisiasi anak muda di desa, kami memberikan pelatihan dan bimbingan untuk meningkatkan kapasitas, baik dalam bidang konservasi dan penelitian maupun pendampingan lembaga. Kami menghubungkan antara anak-anak muda Indonesia yang telah lama berkecimpung di konservasi dan memiliki keahlian di bidangnya dengan anak muda desa, di mana mereka membagi pengetahuan. Dan bagi kami, pemuda desa, memang mereka kurang mendapat kesempatan untuk melanjutkan pendidikan ke jenjang yang lebih tinggi. Nah, pengetahuan baru yang dibagi oleh teman-teman yang telah lama di konservasi ini menjadi satu kebanggaan bagi pemuda desa dan meningkatkan kepercayaan diri dalam menjalankan upaya konservasi yang terencana dan terukur. Nah, ini capaian kami. Dengan pendekatan tersebut, kami mencatat secara saintifik peningkatan jumlah kelelawar maksimum yang bersarang di pulau, yang awalnya 400-an di bulan-bulan tertentu bisa mencapai 35.000 ekor. Ini juga ada ratusan anak-anak serta pemuda di desa yang mengikuti berbagai kegiatan edukasi dan peningkatan kapasitas. Ini sasaran kami yang kedua, yaitu Bantilungku, Baning Sulawesi, Indotest Studio for Steny, di Lembah Palu, Sulawesi Tengah. Spesies ini sudah terancam punah kritis, namun perdagangan terus berlanjut sampai saat ini. bersama kelompok-kelompok pencinta alam di Palu, Sulawesi Tengah, kami belajar meneliti spesies ini di alam liar. Kami belajar dari ahli untuk melakukan survei populasi baning di Sulawesi. Baning ini kalau di daerah kami disebut bantilukung.
Bu Asnim, waktunya ya. 4 menit.
Oh siap. Penelitian kami di Lembah Palu ini pada Juli dari 44 km transek hanya 6 ekor. April di transek 42,4 km tidak ditemukan sama sekali baning Sulawesi. Kami juga mengkonfirmasi bahwa kepada pemburu dan yang lain-lain bahwa baning ini semakin sulit ditemukan. Nah, ini di tahun 2021 sama terancam punah kritis dan dia hanya ada terdistribusi di dua pulau kecil di Sangihe dan di Talaut. Ini kuskus Talaut. Upaya konservasi kuskus Talaut kami ini melakukan survei di Talaut, kemudian dengan pendekatan perlibatan masyarakat kami juga menggunakan anak muda lokal yang diajari cara melakukan survei. Nah, tiga satwa endemik tadi itu yang masing-masing memiliki peran yang berbeda untuk menyediakan jasa ekosistem dan kemudian kekhasan nilai budaya untuk masyarakat setempat. Nah, pengenalan nilai yang dapat dipetik dari jasa ekosistem ini yang diberikan oleh tiga spesies kepada masyarakat adalah tantangan kami, di mana jasa ekosistem bukanlah suatu yang bisa dilihat secara langsung dan menghasilkan uang yang dan cepat dibanding dengan perburuan atau perdagangan satwa. Upaya yang kami lakukan untuk mengenalkan tiga satwa ini untuk menggugah masyarakat. Ini kampanye yang kami lakukan, kami mulai pada tingkat pendidikan sekolah dasar, remaja usia sekolah, dengan harapan di masa datang ketika peran pengambil kebijakan dipegang oleh adik-adik ini, mereka dapat mempertimbangkan jasa ekosistem dan alam Sulawesi sebagai dasar dalam pengambilan kebijakan nantinya. Kami juga berharap bahwa anak-anak akan semakin cinta dengan satwa-satwa di Sulawesi. Buku cerita ini dapat di-download secara gratis di website kami. Kami baru mempunyai dua cerita, yaitu tentang Bani Sulawesi dan Kalong Sulawesi. Nah, ini pemuda-pemudi Sulawesi segera gigi dan lantang. Kami anak muda yang bergerak di tingkat tapak mungkin tidak bisa menghambat laju pembukaan hutan akibat pembangunan, tapi setidaknya kami mengambil peran dalam menghambat kepunahan spesies Sulawesi yang belum dikenal. Progres tidak mungkin melakukan intervensi sendiri di Sulawesi. Tantangannya banyak, upaya konservasinya tidak boleh ditunda. Nah, upaya-upaya yang kami lakukan saat ini diharapkan dapat menginspirasi inisiatif konservasi berbasis masyarakat yang lebih luas. Jangkauan langkah konservasi kami di beberapa wilayah Sulawesi juga dimaksudkan untuk membuka dan menjalin relasi dengan beragam komunitas yang memiliki visi yang sama. Untuk itu kami berusaha terus menjalin relasi. Nah, visi kami memang mendorong masyarakat, terutama kaum muda, untuk melakukan konservasi satwa terancam punah namun terabaikan di Sulawesi. Terima kasih.
Oke, terima kasih Bu Asnim.
Ya, terima kasih.
Luar biasa. So, saya karena ada beberapa audiens dari luar negeri, so I have to speak in English. Just to give summary on this.
Terima kasih, Pak.
Baik. Habis ini kita akan ada sesi tanya jawab, Bu. Jadi saya akan memberikan sekitar 1-2 menit summary. So, this is a very good presentation from Mrs. Asnim from Progress, especially on the neglected species in Sulawesi. There are three species here. The first one is the paniki or the bat species, and the second one is the turtle, the banding Sulawesi, and the last one is the couscous. So these three species actually there are some indications of local extinctions and decreasing in terms of populations. And what they are doing actually, the first one actually do the sum of the monitoring of the population in certain area, and then also engage some of the local people, especially on the how to guard the populations and also do the kind of awareness campaign on the importance of the species. And I can see for Spence as well with the paniki. So the after 3 years there are quite enormous increasing in terms of populations, about 76% of that, and then progress also collaborate with 420 persons on the awareness campaigns. So that's for the paniki for the bats, and then the second one, the turtle as well, because there are a large number of trade for the species, and they would like to have the awareness campaign from the area in the area, and also the couscous. And I think it's good to acknowledge their effort so far, especially engaging their program to the younger generations, and also give a very good awareness on the importance of species, especially on the ecosystem services. I'm sure that my summary is not covering all things because I don't have the presentation, just to give a very speedy wrap up. So I would like to invite everyone in here in an online conference, and also everyone here, you would like to have some questions, please have a question in English and I can translate to Bahasa and then transfer to Bu Asni. Any questions from you all? All of you?
Mas Dugun, saya bisa nanya?
Oh, silakan.
Pakai Indo aja ya, nanti Mas Dugun yang translate. Mbak Anim keren banget ininya presentasinya. Saya ada pertanyaan, Mbak. Tadi kan ada bilang kalau memang agak menantang ya, membuat masyarakat sadar karena jasa lingkungan itu kan tidak nyata seperti yang kita dapatkan kalau misalnya kita berdagang. Boleh cerita nggak gimana proses meyakinkan para pemuda untuk ikut terlibat dalam konservasi dan apa tantangannya dan bagaimana teman-teman di Progress bisa mengatasi itu dan bersama-sama melibatkan pemuda di Sulawesi. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Ardian. Oh ya, biasanya memang seperti peribahasa lama, tak kenal maka tak sayang. Kebanyakan memang kami justru tidak mengetahui bahwa satwa itu istimewa. Misalnya waktu kami mulai dengan poniki atau Indotostudo baning, masyarakat menganggap ini ada di mana saja dan bukan endemik. Jadi mereka membiarkan atau menganggap hal yang biasa kalau mereka menemukan atau menjual, karena dianggap akan ada di mana saja banyak. Tapi setelah kami jelaskan bahwa ini istimewa karena hanya ada di lokasi tertentu, misalnya Indotestudo itu hanya ada di Sulawesi Tengah, walaupun dia endemik Sulawesi, tapi sebarannya hanya di Sulawesi Tengah. Kemudian bahwa ternyata poniki itu dia menyerbukan durian. Jadi kalau tidak ada poniki, kemungkinan durian tidak akan berbuah banyak. Nah itu menarik minat masyarakat dan merasa bangga bahwa mereka memiliki itu. Kalau dengan anak muda, kami di sini memang banyak kelompok pecinta alam, tapi kebanyakan mereka hanya pada petualangan. Nah, ini hal yang menarik ketika kami berbicara tentang konservasi, itu menarik minat mereka. Karena ini hal yang menarik mereka sampai ke puncak-puncak gunung, tapi hanya naik. Nah, sekarang ada beberapa perubahan di kelompok pecinta alam, mereka mulai mengidentifikasi atau mengambil foto. Misalnya ada yang naik Gunung Tambusisi barusan ini, mereka foto semua tentang apa kantong semar. Ada yang mulai foto serangga, walaupun mereka tidak tahu jenis apa, tapi ini ada perubahan. Kalau jasa ekosistem juga misalnya di Kalong. Di Kalong di pulau itu, nelayan mengatakan bahwa, oh saat ini kami memiliki, kami bisa mengambil ikan dengan cepat, tidak perlu lama, dan kemudian ikannya sudah semakin banyak. Nah, mereka berpikir mungkin ada hubungannya dengan pulau yang dilindungi karena jumlah kalong makin banyak. Nah, bisa jadi bahwa itu kotoran kalong, mungkin kotoran kalong yang dibawa ke laut, kemudian meningkatkan apa mineral atau apa di laut sehingga jumlah ikan semakin banyak atau semakin besar. Itu kami justru dapat dari masyarakat dan mereka tertarik untuk ikut membantu karena mereka baru tahu bahwa ini istimewa dan membawa manfaat.
Baik.
Begitu ya, Adrian.
Luar biasa Bu Asnim. Mas Adiantono, ini luar biasa loh jawabannya dan ada beberapa yang menarik dan Saya mungkin tidak bisa menambah pertanyaannya lagi karena waktu, tapi saya coba translate in English for all the audience here. So actually, Mr. Adiantono asking about the tips on engaging people for this program. Part of that, C-Talks, one of the tips actually give the real information to the local people on for this target species, because maybe like the community, they don't know that let's say like the turtle only belongs to the certain area in the central Sulawesi, and then this, it's very endemic here. And also mentioning about let's say the bats, actually part of the, if you know durian, the king of fruits, is the one of the agents of the pollination. So this is a very, very important fruit for people. And then when they realize the important roles of these pollinators, so they would like to contribute on this program. And I think it's good to have this kind of tips, and including a part of the bats produce the guano, and guano released to the sea area. And then the sea, and then it impacts also the abundance of the fish for the fishermen. Part of that kind of connection, maybe it's good to have also in our areas. And because of time, I would say thank you very much, Bu Asnim, for your talk, even in Bahasa. Hopefully everyone do understand in my summary in English, and hopefully because at the time I have to move to the next one. Thank you again. Terima kasih banyak, Bu Asnim. And
sama-sama, terima kasih.
Sehat-sehat terus, dan semoga tambah sukses dengan progresnya.
Amin.
So the next one is our distinguished guest from quite far away from Costa Rica. So Miss Carolina Sáenz Balanos from Econfis. So she will give a talk on human wildlife conflict in indigenous communities of the Najri Awari indigenous territory of East Central Costa Rica. Apologize if I spell it wrongly. So if you have your presentations ready, time is yours for 12 minutes presentation and then 8 minutes for the questions. So time is yours. Yeah, you have your screen shared, and okay.
Okay, sorry, I am going again. Sorry for the time here. So good evening in America and good morning in Asia. As you say, I'm going to talk about the human wildlife conflict in one of the indigenous community here in Costa Rica. Just to have an idea about the indigenous population in Latin America is between the 8 to 9%, and in Costa Rica the indigenous people represent almost 2.5 of the population. And this is the Costa Rica map. In green areas you can see all the protected areas that we have, and in orange are the indigenous territories. We have 24 indigenous territories representing 8 indigenous groups, and the Cabecar group is the second largest group for the country. And I am going to focus on Nairi Awari, that is this small 2 polygons in that area, that is the Nairi Awari. And for Cabecar people, the pigs are very important, because they can use pigs as a trade, as a coin, food, and also they are very important for spiritual ceremonies when someone passes away. So for that reason, pigs are another kind or another member of the family. For that reason, people don't like to keep the animals in enclosure. So it's easy to find pigs inside of the jungle, and that is easier to get attacked by wildlife. But the reason I want to know what species indigenous people consider as a problematic species and get some negative impacts. And with this background, now we have that the habitat fragmentation is easier to some animals come out to the jungle, to the forest, and get more interactions with people. Also, these animals come out because they have less habitat, and also sometimes there is not enough food in the forest, so these animals come out to try to find easy food or only pass in areas where normally they use as a habitat. So with in indigenous areas, sometimes it's difficult to have a job in that area, job opportunities. So people hunt wildlife to get some income or also to get food. And that caused that in some occasions, species like a jaguar, puma, or another carnivores come out to the forest and get like pigs, cows, or other animals. So people get mad and remove the animal from the jungle. So that is an example with big cats, but we have we are going to show another species that also cause some interaction with that people. So for that reason, I want to know which species they consider as a problematic. I apply a questionnaire to people in that indigenous territory, only to people older than 18 years old. And with the answers that I got from the questionnaire, I classify the in six levels to conduct a descriptive analysis to see which species are considered as a problematic and which are the problems that they cause. So for that reason, I divide livestock attacks from pig attacks for that thing that I explained at the beginning. Also, I classify the poultry attacks, crop impact, and physical risks for human beings and others. And it's important to say that the crop impact also happened because these people have to do the plantation or the crops far away from the houses because pigs are around there. So for that reason, they have to go far away to do this. And also after to get these species, I also ask about possible solutions to reduce the interactions and negative impacts to them. So for that reason, I use another five groups or five categories according with the relationship or similarities that they have. So as a result, I got 16 species that they consider as a problematic. And overall, the 68 of the interviewed people considered as a jaguar or puma as a problematic species. And if we see this graphic, the jaguar is the most cited species. And if we see the jaguar or puma as a big predatory, were cited 12 times, and for livestock were 7 times. So when we see these people that consider jaguar or puma as a problematic, all the, well, 86% that people consider these animals as a problematic were divided between 55% considered as a pig predatory species and 32 for a livestock or another cattle. And the other are less percentage. But something interesting, because I want to have a window to see what they think about the species that caused this problem. If we see livestock and pigs, we only have two species and we have less cases or less sighted from people than if we see poultry attacks, we have like hog, snake, jaguarundi, and opossum, coyote, ocelot, taira, and jaguar. We have more species and we have more attacks, and people don't get mad as they get when they lost a pig. So for that reason, it's important to understand a little bit why that animals are important to them. And also, if we see the crops, crop impacts, we have also more species like aquari, aguri, collared peccary, paca, and red-brocket deer. But also, people don't get mad with these species because also these species are important food to them. So even though they sometimes get losses in their crops, they get some benefits because they also can hunt these species in their lands. And for human risk, we only have like two species, and actually we don't have any attacks in the country for big cats. And the most common is poison snakes that people, because they work in the field.
You have 4 minutes.
Okay, thank you. And also I asked about the people that have livestock and how many of them get some predation. And is seeing that people that have only pigs are more susceptible to get some jaguar attacks or puma attacks compared when they have a mix of livestock. When I ask them what they think or how they perceive the situation in the future, most of them say that the situation is going to be the same amount of cases per year. Few people think that it's going to increase, and less people think that it's going to be lower. And for the possible solutions, it's important because they know that what they have to do, that they have to improve their management of the animals. And also they know that they have to, one of the ways to scare away the animal using some weapons or animals to make that noise. And it's interesting to see here that 16% of the people think that kill the feline is the solution, even though that the feline is very important for their culture. And other people say that you cannot do anything, or they don't know, or and other things. So as conclusions, the jaguar, hawks, opossums, and collared peccary are the species that cause more negative interactions in that community. That people know, or they think, that building enclosure, reducing the animal numbers, and scaring away the predator are the keys to lessening the conflict. And the Nairiewari indigenous territory, they might have an attitude or cultural norm that in their context, removing an animal is seen something correct. Is the correct option in order to maintain their livelihood. And finally, that people to wildlife managers or people who work with in conservation, they have to understand the social constructions in order to address the future actions. And that is what I have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Carol. What a very interesting talk. And I can see some similarity happening in Sumatra, especially with the using your, we call it the proof enclosure for the tigers in Sumatra, and for the social aspect, this is something that I learned by myself as well on why we should concern about this one. So without further ado, do you have any questions from the participants here to Ms. Caroline? Okay, one from Mr. Ardiantono. Interesting talk, Carolina. Do you think when respondents cited jaguar and puma as problematic, is it because they are more well-known due to their size, fame, stories, etc., or they are in fact are indeed problematic in the real life? Could you answer that quickly, please?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it's in both sides. In general, in the country, a lot of people have the belief that jaguar or puma are very dangerous, but that is because they have oral traditions that pass from generation to generation. So even people that in the city that we don't have jaguars here in the city, people think that jaguars are here and are very dangerous. And in their culture or in rural areas, there are more common to have some animals or to find footprints or actually have some predation. So I think that is, in that case, if they have both. Sometimes they even don't any see, or the young people don't see a jaguar or puma yet, but they think that the jaguar is close and is the species that cause some problems. Even though sometimes it's a snake that killed the animal and they found days later and they say, oh, was a jaguar or was a puma. I think that it can be in both ways. Is some from general traditions and other because they actually have some interactions, but I can say in low cases actually is the animal that caused the problem.
Okay, I'm sure we have one more question, just another 3 minutes left. Any questions? Okay, so if not, maybe because we come late, so I would like to appreciate for your talk here, a very good presentations and very interesting one. And thank you very much. I'm sure over there is almost 10 p.m. right in Costa Rica. It's a bit late there. So thank you very much for your participation and a very good talk for the presentations. Next one. I would like to invite Dr. Laura Patricia Porras Murillo from Instituto Internacional en Conservación y Manejo de Vida Silvestre, Universidad Nacional. I'm sorry if I pronounced it wrongly. So she will talk about human-wildlife interactions in a major tourist destinations, Manuel Antonio National Park in Costa Rica. So if you're ready, Dr. Laura, could you please?
Okay, are you seeing my?
Yes, yes, okay. I can see then, I can hear your voice loud and clear. So the time is yours, 12 minutes for the talk and then 8 minutes for the questions. Time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Good morning or good night or good evening. Well, I'm going to talk about wildlife human interactions in a national park here in Costa Rica. There are multiple social and ecological factors that contribute to humans and wildlife interacting with each other. One of these factors is the popularity of tourism or related to wildlife observation. Basically, more important in unprotected areas. Tourists feel safe, satisfied when they have more control and closer contact with wildlife. So they also are looking for be closer to animals. The main problem of tourism in protected areas are due to the overcrowding of people in specific areas, such in this photograph, which can generate stress on animals. The emotion of the tourist when they are seeing an animal, a wild animal, can cause it to get too close and generate low noises and try to touch the animals or even to catch them. Disturbance caused by tourism can generate immediate change in wildlife behavior. We have reports of some changes in immediate changes and medium and long-term effects, such as increasing aggressiveness of animals, altering their activity and feeding patterns, change in their distributions and abundance also. In addition, wild animals habituated to the presence of humans can be vectors of disease. And this is a major problem if we are talking about some animals that can be aggressive with tourists and maybe such bite. High tourist visitation in Manuel Antonio National Park has generated negative effects on wildlife. For example, presence of food, from human origin in the diet of the white-faced monkeys and raccoons also. Also, wildlife feeding was banned by law in Costa Rica in 1992, and the amount of food that tourists can enter to the park was restricted in 2015. The problem is continuous. We have a tourist feeding animals or trying to feeding animals or trying to get closer to the animals all the time. Sometimes or most of the times for a good photo. Monkeys and raccoons are habituated to human feeding and they often steal food and have even learned to open bags and backpacks and various containers looking for food, resulting this in conflicts with people. For example, 46% of the diet of the white-faced monkeys consists of food from tourists, and its action range has been compressed to the areas with tourist presence on the park. Raccoons have decreased their home range within the park between 1990 and 2016 to concentrate on areas most used by tourists. Also, a change in activity pattern has been identified from a twilight behavior to daytime with peaks of activity in lunch time when all the tourists have their lunch. Protected areas with high visitation are the ideal scenarios to evaluate the possible effects of interaction between people and wildlife. And these interactions between tourists and wildlife I recognize for their complexity. So the information about these items in order to have information for a better management of visitors and the protected areas, not only in Manuel Antonio National Parks, but in the other protected areas of the country, and well, we hope other protected areas of the region. The objectives of the work was describe spatially and temporarily the interactions between tourists and wildlife in Manuel Antonio National Park, and to identify types of interaction that occur most frequently, and the species that interact the most, and whether the different types of interactions are related to any species. Well, this is a view of Manuel Antonio National Park. It was created on 1972. It's a small national park. It's a very small area in the country. Has terrestrial area and marine area. It's one of the protected areas with the greatest scenic beauty in the country. The Forbes call it one of the 12 most beautiful national parks in the world, and it's the most national park, the most visited national park in Costa Rica, and has a rapid growth in annual tourist visitation from some 25,000 tourists in 1982 to half a million of tourists in 2018. With a pandemic situation, this is now is changing, but that's the data before the pandemic situation. The visitation in this park, it seats 1,000 people daily and can be higher during weekends or holidays until more than 300 people. And I repeat, it's a small national park, small area. Well, what we do, we collect data. The interactions were observed in 2012 and between May 2015 and January 2020, except for 2017. Data were taken in periods of 2 to 3 consecutive days, at least 2 times on each season. We have dry and rainy season. Data were collected for 7 days in the first year, 3 days in 2015, and so on. We walk along the trails and beaches inside of the park between 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. That's the hours that the park are open to the tourists, and we register each interaction that we can detect. For each interaction, we recorded a site, time, date, type of interaction, and the species that participate in the interactions. This is Costa Rica, and here is the Manuel Antonio National Park, is this area. We have, this is the trails inside the park, and those are the beaches. We did generalize linear models to the analysis. We want to see if what was the temporal and spatial dynamics of the interactions. We have a response variable that was number of daily interaction, and the explanatory variables, day and season, time and site.
You have 4 minutes.
Also, we identified which type of interaction is more frequent, and we include a model to determine if there was any relationship between the species and the type of interaction. We include two species in more of the analysis, because it was the species that more interact with tourists. What we found 2,000 and almost 3,000 interactions between wildlife and tourists, 13 types of interaction, and tourists interact with 40 species, but more with white-faced monkeys and raccoons. Those are the interactions that we found related to feeding, closeness, and cold. And this is what we found. The interactions related to food are the more frequent in the park. Here we have white-faced monkeys was the species that more interact with tourists. And in the three types of interactions. We have the mean of daily interactions between humans and wildlife according to day, season, daily time period, and site. And we found here some things interesting that, for example, the day with higher interactions was Thursday. And this is because Mondays, the park is closed on Mondays. So we think the animals are just like waiting for the tourists coming on Thursday to get food from tourists. There was more interactions on dry season, and this is because it's the best season to visit the park, not only for national people, but for international tourism. And the beaches, especially Manuel Antonio Beach, was the site on the more of the interactions occur, and also in one of the trails that is the entrance to the park. And we have also more interactions at the noon, which is the hour of when people have lunch. So that means that the food is available for the animals. With this data, we think that the park and the people working on conservation on the park have to incorporate in education campaigns information related to human to animal welfare and the negative effect of tourism can have on protected areas. That's because when we talk with tourists, they can understand that they are doing something wrong with animals, but maybe they don't have the information to make a change. Also, we need to promote in tourism that follows an appropriate behavior of observation and respectful appreciation of wildlife. Try to avoid that kind of things of to be close to the animal, to get a a nice photo for Facebook or Instagram or something. And also the main cause of negative interactions between wildlife and tourists in this park was food. So it's necessary to changing the amount of and types of food that entering at the park. And also we need to change the behavior of tourists and the disposal of waste. The idea will be every tourist take the garbage from away the park. And management of tourism and carrying capacity of the park should be improved. That's an important thing. In addition to promoting the use of all trails in the park and avoid saturation in some places where principal where more interactions occur at this moment. So we think human-wildlife interactions and the conflicts that result are a consequence of human actions. The animals are not looking for food from tourist food naturally. They do that because they can, they have the food there. So management measures should be aimed to controlling these human actions and not wildlife populations. And that's it. Thanks for your time.
I can say gracias. Just one. Okay. There are two questions actually here, but you have about 6 minutes and a half. And then if you can, there is two questions. First from Miss Mary and Mrs. Mary, and the second one from Arisa. Maybe I will read the one from Ibu Miss Mary. Questions to Laura: in the situation of closer wildlife human interactions in the national park, do you observe change of behavior of wildlife that might affect environmental services? Do you find wildlife have become sedentary or inactive? That's the first question. And the second one about, do you have a communication strategy to educate and make tourists aware of that kind of interaction in the national parks, such as feeding and blah, blah, blah. And then, especially this is related with the wildlife conservation effort, of course.
Okay. Yes, we observe the first question. We observe some changes that not only affect the environmental services but affect all the ecosystem because we have raccoons are now a daily species when they used to be a species that are active at night. So the dynamic change a lot of things, not only the behavior of the raccoon, but all related to the raccoons. And we have some changes like that. The wildlife is not sedentary or inactive, but is more stressed because they are looking for food with where tourists are and can be attacked each other to get food, so they are more stressed and some anxious because they this kind of relationship. And the other question, we have with this project since 2012, so we made different things. Right now we have a video that we play on the entrance of the park just to people see what can we do and what can we cause with this kind of feeding animals, and we are trying to make a big communication strategy. It is just complicated because this national park is one of the national parks that have more entrance, it means more money for the government, so it has some things that we can't do a lot of things because of that, but we are trying to work little by little, trying to educate the people, tourists, and educate people since they get to the airport, basically international tourists, and also national tourists, working with children and doing some kind of books for children, and they can understand why it's not a good thing to touch animals or to feed animals.
Okay. Thank you very much for this. There's, you still have 2 minutes. There's another question for Mr. Sulaksana. So from your presentation, any positive impact between human tourists with wildlife or all interaction make negative impact?
Okay. The survey was just for negative interactions, but we promote the positive interactions that are observation of wildlife, and you can observe wildlife and you can take videos and take photos and sit in a place just to see the animals interacting between them. We promote that, but in this case, we only record the negative interactions, but it's a good idea to record the positive interactions also.
Okay, thank you very much for your answers and the presentation. This is a very interesting talk from you, and thank you very much. I know it's very late over there. Buenas noches.
Buenas noches.
Gracias for your time. I just know that. Today. And thank you very much, and we will appreciate for your participation here for the webinar. Thank you very much, and have a pleasant day. So the next one, I will invite Miss Neo Yuan Vivian from Nanyang Technological University. So she will give a talk on updated trends of reported human tiger conflict in Riau, Sumatra. Well, this is a very nice talk because I just heard that also a couple weeks ago about the attack of tiger. So Miss Ne, so
hi, call me Vivian.
Oh, Vivian. Okay, Miss Vivian. I'm sorry. So if you're ready, please give your talk, and then we have 12 minutes for presentation and 8 minutes for the questions. Time is yours.
I will share my screen.
Can you share your presentations?
I think I need to.
Okay.
I think I need to restart because my permission doesn't allow.
Oh, so can the committee please give the permissions to Ms. Vivian? You have the right to do the share screen?
Okay.
Okay, get it. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, you see the...
It's showing now.
Okay.
Okay. Could you please turn? Yeah, okay. Get it. Okay, time is yours now.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Vivian. I'm from Nanyang Technological University, Singapore. So I'll be presenting my abstract, plantations and residential areas as sites of high human tiger conflicts in Riau, Sumatra. After the extinction of the Javan and Bali tigers, Sumatran tigers are the only subspecies of tigers that are left that are endemic to Indonesia. Their numbers have drastically declined since the mid-20th century, and they are currently classified as critically endangered on the IUCN Red List. So land use change in Sumatra has reduced the forest extent from 16.1 million hectares to around 12.1 million hectares between 2001 to 2019. And the remaining forest is becoming increasingly fragmented. So this forces tigers into human-dominated landscapes that lead to human-tiger conflicts. The threat of tiger attacks on livestock and people can result in tiger persecution, which can threaten tiger conservation. currently there's no publicly available database for conflicts in Riau from 2010 to 2020. And this lack of data is important because Riau was identified as the province with the second highest number of fatal attacks of human tiger conflicts from 1979 to 1997. And since that time, there's been large-scale landscape change due to widespread deforestation to clear land for plantation. So given the lack of data in such a highly deforested and critical province, we aim to compile human-tiger conflict events reported from 2010 to 2020 in Riau and map up the distribution of these events at the village level. So for our methods, we collected data from online news reports from 8 different sources. So this is a mix of international, provincial, and national sources. And so for each source, we did a comprehensive search using keywords, harimau for tiger and conflict manusia dan harimau for human tiger conflict from 2010 up to 2020. And we compiled all the relevant news sources. So we use web scripting on R to R programming language using the package RVEST. And so this is to automate the extraction of the title, date of publication, and body text for all our articles. And so how this works is that the format of and layout of the web page is coded for using a language called cascading style sheets. And this right side of the picture shows the cascading style sheets viewer in Google Chrome. So we use selected keywords to automatically extract information from the website using R programming, something like what you can see here. Yeah, so this greatly speeds up the process of collecting information from news sources. And after that, the location of conflicts were extracted from the text used by matching the village, sub-district, and district names. So we use packages like StringBiz, Corpus, and Tidyverse on R. And because many news sources were used, we had to remove duplicates. So events that are in the same location and published within 1 week of each other is considered one unique event. So from this, we obtain 101 unique human-tiger conflict events, and then we characterize them to get information like number of tigers, conflict type, and type of conflict location. So we base our definition of conflict type using the Indonesian government's definition of human-tiger conflict types under the Indonesian Ministry of Environmental and Forestry Law, which is stated here. And so there are 7 conflict types, which is sightings, livestock killed, human killed, humans injured, tigers killed, tigers injured, and tigers evacuated. And we also broadly categorize the locations into 4 types: residential area, which is all settlements and homes, plantations, which is all both privately and company-owned plantations, including acacia and oil palm, and forest and forest edge. So then we map the conflict events to the village administrative boundaries. And onto our results. During this 11 years from 2010 to 2020, 101 conflict events with 107 conflict types were recorded in 74 villages. So there's a difference because each unique conflict event can have more than one conflict type. For example, a tiger can prey on a goat and injure a human on the same village in the same day. So this will be considered one unique conflict event with 2 conflict types. The tiger sightings made up the majority of conflict types, with 57 sightings in total, and is followed by livestock, where there are 18 incidents of livestock being killed, which resulted in at least 34 animals killed, and 6 tigers are killed, 3 injured, 3 evacuated by authorities. A total of 11 people are killed and 9 are injured from tiger attacks in Riau. So most human-tiger conflict events that reported the exact number of tigers involved reported only 1 tiger, and the largest number of tigers is 5. So most of the conflicts occurred in plantations and residential areas, while few were reported in forests and on forest edges. So most of the human-tiger conflict types in residential and plantation areas are sightings, but there are more humans injured or killed by tigers in the plantations compared to residential areas. And the second highest conflict type reported in residential areas are livestock killed. So we can see here when we plot the number of human-tiger conflict events and types over time, can see an overall increase where the numbers from 2018 to 2020 is about 4 times from 2011 to 2017. And this is mostly because of an increased number of sightings, which is this shade over here. And for our distribution, on the left, we have a figure which shows a spatial distribution of the villages with human-tiger conflicts along with current forest cover and deforestation since 2009. So the village with the highest number of human-tiger conflicts is Tanjung Simpang, with 13 conflicts occurring in this village, resulting in 6 human deaths, 1 injury, 1 livestock death, and 2 problem tiger evacuations. And this was a famous case of Bonita, which had some peculiar behavior for tigers. And so our study shows that a majority of human-tiger conflict events occurred in plantations and residential areas, as these are sites of high human activity and disturbances compared to forests and forest edges. So this indicates an overlap in resources shared by humans and tigers. And this aligns with results from similar studies in Sumatra, which found that the probability of human-tiger conflicts is higher in areas closer to settlements or areas with intermediate disturbance, and lower in sites with lower disturbance like protected forests. So although many plantations in Riau are monoculture plantations like oil palm, they can still harbor generally smaller species like wild boars that can be prey for tigers. And the depletion of wild prey populations due to increased human-tiger conflicts can result in increasing frequency of human-tiger conflicts as the tigers enter the villages to seek out prey such as livestock. So some discussion points about web scraping of online news sources to collect data. It is a cost-effective and relatively quick way to gather spatial temporal information on human-wildlife conflict. But there are limitations, such as reportings can have inconsistencies and definitions can differ across sources. There's also a level of imprecision. Many articles use general terms like many chickens eaten instead of reporting actual numbers. And the exact location is often not reported, and it can also limit how precisely we can categorize each location type. And there are also several potential biases. For example, what is considered newsworthy? For example, sightings are more likely to be underreported as opposed to attacks by tigers. And also the high number of people in residential areas can also lead to reporting bias, and differing access to telecommunications across the years and across villages can also cause biases, as many sightings are reported because the videos of tiger sightings go viral, and that's how they reach the attention of the news sources. So in summary, Sumatran tigers have high conservation value, and they have been the center of many conservation efforts in Sumatra. However, it's important to document and monitor these human-tiger conflict cases to ensure that these efforts don't burden the communities that live close to tigers, and also to minimize the threat of retaliatory killings on tigers due to conflicts. So some key takeaways is that there's a recent upward trend of human-tiger conflicts mainly attributed to sightings, and that plantations and residential areas are sites to be targeted for human-tiger conflict prevention and mitigation efforts. And also important future work is to understand and assess social and biophysical variables that drive conflicts. Something similar to what Argentino shared just now. And with that, I'll come to the end of my presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can you put your slide number 19, because we cannot see. Maybe you do the connections maybe. Just for that. Thank you very much for the talk, Ms. Vivian. You exactly on time. So let's have questions for all the audience. I can see one question from again, Ardiantono. Very interesting talk, Vivian. Do you consider the reporting effort in this study In example, more reporting on tiger conflict in recent years because more attention has been given. How you deal with this? So you can answer this question, and then after that, we can have another questions. Please.
Okay. We didn't really factor in that, but it's something that we acknowledge is a big thing, especially there's an increased trend of human-tiger conflict sightings in the recent years, and so a big possibility as to why that is the case can be because there's more attention, and so it becomes more newsworthy to report tiger conflicts. I mean, to report tiger sightings, even if no one is injured or no livestock is killed. And also, we also think that it's possible that the increased access to telecommunications also can contribute to this. Yes.
Okay, anything else? Would like to ask? If not, I have one question here. So I know that you mentioned about the web scraping, that kind of things. It happened to me to for the other, because we try to collect the information for that one. How you deal with the repetition, especially because sometimes, and especially with the precisions of the information, sometimes the journalists actually pick the same information but put it wrongly. For example, numbers of the incident and sometimes the locations. How you deal with this? Because this is something that quite important to me to know from your experience.
So we only took the events that are reported. When we pick the articles, we only pick those that are reporting the event that occurred. So we don't pick those that are like reviewing the event from a long time after, or those that are compiling events, because yeah, as you mentioned, there can be inconsistencies, and it can also lead to the same event being reported twice in our data. So we only pick those that are reporting events that just occurred. And also we have mentioned that that the event in the same location that is published within 1 week is considered one incident. So this is it can be a bit of an underestimate, mm-hmm. Because the village can be quite big, but it's a way of making things more consistent. Because there's especially when we use a lot of news sources, a lot of events will be reported multiple times in that week.
Okay, thank you. Is there anything else for Ms. Vivian from all of us here, all the participants? If not, that thank you very much for your talk.
I just realized that I haven't unmuted myself. I have one quick question for Vivian. How long it takes for you to do all of this web scraping?
The whole project was around 6 months, but this is not just the web scraping, but that part was shorter. But I don't really remember the exact time. Yeah,
because I was thinking it would be cool if you replicate this kind of study in other provinces in Sumatra, right? Yeah. And see like the overall trend in Sumatra. Or maybe with elephant also, Mas Dogun.
That's our questions, because we did compiling like this similarly, and then the hardest one actually to, because we know the locations very well, and then we can do the other things maybe, not only from the news, but also with our contact person on the ground. And this is something that I think it's good to have kind of discrepancy between the finding based on the analysis like you did here, and also the reality on the ground. I think it's good to have that kind of a comparison in some way to look at the pattern on how precise is the information being presented by the journalists. And I think this is a very good one. I like it. 2 minutes more. Do you have any questions from the audience? If not, then we can move to the last presenters here. And I'm sure we are getting hungry, right? Before lunch. Okay, so if not, then I have to say thank you very much. This is a very, very good talk. And then really appreciate for your participation from the WECMIC. And thank you very much. The last one, I would invite Pak Yudi Irawan Eshoud from Javan Species Recovery Program, Leicester Zoo. He will give a talk on the community-based conservation of Javan warty pig, Sus varicosus, in Java, Indonesia. And I think this is one of the rarest pig in Java, right? So Pak Yudi, are you ready? Okay. You're muting. Turn on. Okay. I cannot hear your voice.
The sound is clear?
Yeah. Loud and clear. And okay. Please share your presentations.
And thanks for the opportunity, Pak Doni. And hello everyone. My name is Yudi, and now I will share our study about community-based conservation of Javan warty pig in Java, Indonesia. And as we know, in Java have two species pig, the Suscropa and Sus varicosus. But when we see the distribution of Suscropa in West Java on Java, the almost Suscropa we can find everywhere, every elevation from lowland forest until mountain forest. But Sus varicosus only found in small area in Java and mostly in lowland forest. Now the population more than 50% at least 3 generations make the Japan warty pig now is endangered species. And then on 2016, Zahra and Rode Margono conduct study with Japan warty pig, and this is a first ecology for Japan warty pig in the mainland of Java. They survey in 7 areas in Java, but the 3 survey areas didn't find a population of Japan warty pig anymore. So the results of the population continue to decline. And then we conduct next study in here, and we put some camera trap in potential Sus varicosus habitat. But the results are on the maps, you can see, and everywhere is a Suscropa. We only found the Sus varicosus mostly in Pangandaran area. And we only found the Sus varicosus in 16 station detection with 41 independent image. And then threat of Japan warty pig in remaining habitat. Actually, on the Japan warty pig, the threat by generally by hybridization and pig hunting activity. And Drigala et al. Already confirmed about this study, this hybridization, and they sample wild JWP sample, and they found that from 9 samples, only 4 samples is pure Japan warty pig, and the other is hybridization. And the other hand, the Japan warty pig treated by the pig hunting activity with a separate purpose, protect plantation, hobby, pig dog fight activity, and commercial purpose. So on generally, on the habitat, they treat on the pressure with Suscropa and make the hybridization, and the other they pressure with pig hunting activity. And also beside that, the Japan warty pig is unnoticed because the unprotected, pest, ugly, and on Islamic religion, this species is haram. And then our goal is we want to secure survival of Japan warty pig in remaining habitat, and ultimate downlist to from endangered to vulnerable. And we want to build a multidisciplinary project and make one area secure for the species. And we want to decrease human JWP conflict. The problem is when we want to secure Japan warty pig in remaining habitat, this species is pest species, so make a low support from the local community. So for the first step, we want to make establish decrease human jaguar conflict with the established effective method to protect plantation from the pig. Actually, for the first step, we want to conduct this method and study area in Batu Karas Pangandaran on January until August 2021. We conduct study in Batu Karas. This is a non-conservation area, but on this area, habitat for Japan woolly pig and the forest convert to farmland. They say in area the farmland is huma, and usually they convert the forest for planting the tree albasia. But until waiting the tree albasia grow up, they planting the other plantation such as rice field, corn, and the other to additional benefit for the community. And this is a last condition after 1 year. So actually this farmland just used for 1 year. So after 1 year, they move to other site to convert forest again. And we found the 16 method. Actually, we found the 16 method to protect plantation by literature and interview with local hunter. The problem is the most effective method is, I think, is so expensive for the local community. So we retest again some method considered to cost and possible to use for all community, and also can move to other area because our study in we testing the method on the huma. So after focus group discussion, we choose our method is a traditional method. We combine a traditional method, and we also use a physical barrier, net fence and wire fence. And this is expensive, but the can protect large area and also have a effect, shock effect to the pig. This is a material for traditional method. We actually for the traditional method, we combine to visual, pregnance, and sounds. We use for pregnance, we use human urine and also camper and human hair. And then is installation for wire fence, installation for net fence, and installation for electric fence. And for implementation method, we select area 25 meter per 25 meter square, and we also put on plantation control plot. It means plantation without not some method. So we want to see how damage pig on the control plot, and then we want to see the how the plot with the sum method.
You have
and
5 minutes.
And we also set up camera trap on the plot for see the other pest on the plot, and also put the camera trap in near plot to see the present damage Japan woolly pig in near plot. For the effectiveness method, we see by the present damage by pig in the plot, and also we see the benefit cost ratio analysis. This is a result about a present damage pest in all plot. Actually, the problem on the plot is many damage by other pests. So look like insect, rodent, monkey, and we only found the damage on the control plot. So it's mean a pig is not main pest on the main. A pig not main pest on the study set, but when we actually they any pest on the pest on plot such as insect and the other. So for the analysis, we only use plot with less or not damaged by other pest to see the effectiveness. This is a result of benefit cost ratio. From we calculate the benefit cost ratio, just net fan and combined with traditional method, it have a benefit to farmland, but wire fan is traditional method have a net cost benefit cost ratio under one. So it's mean the not possible to develop, but it's because the have other external factor to make the productivity is low. With the good condition actually on this plot, we must have 200 kilogram, but when we try this study, we just only get 40 kilogram on corn. So it's make a benefit cost ratio under one. This is the last condition plot that not damaged by pig, net fans combined, wire fans combined, electric fans, and traditional method. It's the plantation is good without damage by pig, and also the damage by pig in control plot. When we see the monitoring and also see on camera trapping, we found that when around the pig damage on the control plot around 7 days by two pig, but I think it's a minimum encounter on the plot because we just put one camera trap on the plantation. And then we also found the damage by pig in the other area. This area is around less than 1 hectare and not set up any protection in here, and damage by pig more than 50%. And when we monitoring the traditional method set up the middle of grow plantation, and we see the pig track and on wire fan and net fan before the traditional method, but after the traditional method after we install the traditional method, no damage anything until harvest time. And then other result, maintenance of camera trapping in near habitat and near plot, we found the 35 and even on 7 camera trap, 5 camera trap, and we also found the 5 possible hybrid in this area. Conclusion, the damage by pig only found in control plot, no protection anything. Based on camera trapping and monitoring, to individual pig can lose all plantation around 10 days before harvest time, but the use traditional method and the other can prevent the damage by pig. And also the BCR value for the next net fence and traditional method is effective and possible to develop, but sometimes the damage plantation not only by pig, and there are some external factor to make plantation low benefit for the farmer. And then a recommendation, camera trapping, and after we interview from the local community, usually the pig damage in near harvest time. So we suggest to near harvest time and need additional protection from the farmland. This is some additional protection. I think we suggest for small growth host, usually they protect with the dog, and also this protect farmland with lodong. In Pangandaran, this method is lodong, and I don't know the Indonesian or English is. And this method used with the spiritus and
it's like acetylene gland, right?
Yeah, just not get just make a shock to the pest like a monkey on and the pig.
Very nice.
And for the next step, we want to retest some method to protection again, because we found some plantation is damaged by other pests. So for the effectiveness, we not clear to see the effectiveness. We also want to make a good bit to protect plantation, and for next year, hopefully we can do the collaboration with hunter. We want to make apa namanya? We want to hunter just kill a Cecropa and steal and make a jawaban our typical lab, and if the second option they can give to us to, and we will accept in some rescue facility and release Japan World Typic on the other remaining habitat or save on Chikananga Captive Breeding Center, or the other option we want to introduction the conservation area for example is Baluran National Park. We know in Baluran National Park I think they have a program to introduction a Japan World Typic in there, and then the other. And terima kasih.
Okay, terima kasih Pak Yudi. Yeah. Very nice talk and very good presentations. And you have exactly 12 minutes for the presentation. And now you have 8 minutes for the questions. Any question to Pak Yudi from the audience here? Okay, one question from Pak Farhan Adin. Nice talk, Mas. Does the damage depend on crops preference? Is it also influenced by density? Can you elaborate that?
Just the damage depend on crop. Sorry, Mas Doni, can you translate again to Bahasa? I think I prefer to answer with Bahasa.
Mas Dogun, unmute. Still mute.
Sorry. Yeah. I can translate it to you. So,
yeah.
Yang satu adalah pertanyaannya, apakah kerusakan yang terjadi itu sangat tergantung terhadap preferensi tanamannya, jadi jenis tanamannya. Kemudian, apakah juga tergantung apa dipengaruhi oleh kepadatan? Ini mungkin kepadatannya maksudnya kepadatan si babinya ya. Kalau menurut saya, logika pertanyaannya. Mungkin kalau salah silakan ditambahkan chatnya Pak Farhan. Jadi seperti itu Mas, jadi kira-kira apakah kerusakannya tergantung jenis tertentu atau malah tergantung apa jumlah babinya.
Yes, I think kita memiliki tanaman jagung dan kacang itu karena berdasarkan preferensi food dari babi itu sendiri. Nah, sebelumnya kan kita wawancara dengan masyarakat lokal bahwa tanaman yang paling dirusak di lokasi tersebut adalah kacang dan jagung. Jadi makanya kita mencoba menguji coba di lahan uji coba itu kacang dan jagung. Kemudian untuk terkait kepadatan untuk babi itu sendiri, kita kan survei juga di sekitar plot studi, kita memasang kamera trap dan ternyata ada beberapa individu babi di lokasi tersebut, dan harusnya sih berdasarkan harvest panen sebelumnya itu kan di sana ada lahan pertanian juga, dan di sana itu banyak yang dirusak itu. Jadi ketika kita melakukan uji coba di sana dan ketika survei memasangkan kamera di sana dan ternyata masih ada babi, harusnya sih di sana itu harusnya dirusak. Tapi ketika kita melakukan pemasangan beberapa metode, itu cukup efektif. Tapi untuk masalah effectiveness, itu harus di retest again, karena beberapa tanaman itu banyak yang dirusak oleh satwa hama yang lain.
Jadi kalau dipengaruhi oleh kepadatan babinya gimana? Belum tahu juga ya, karena itu hanya tergantung jenis tanaman saja ya?
Iya.
Okay, so just want to give the summary in English. So based on the questions here, so actually the damage, the researchers pick the highest preference for the pigs, which is the two highest crop will be the peanuts and corn, maize, yeah, and that's why they pick based on the pattern of that. And actually, is it also influenced by the density? Based on his answer, he doesn't know quite sure about that, because he just picked the locations based on the preference of the crops. Am I my experience right? Okay. You have another 2 minutes. So another question, one more question before we close all the sessions here. Anything want to ask? If not, I will have one question actually. So because of this rarest of the species, do you have a plan to make a kind of small sanctuary in Pangandaran? Because you mentioned about the one that is Java, right, in Baluran. So is there any potential location for that, or your study area will be the other options for, like, let's say we call it Javan Wartipik Sanctuary in Wat Pangandaran. Do you have plans about that?
I think it's a small rescue, just a small, not a big rescue, but just a small rescue. Or we want to, yeah, I think the maximum for pipes individual, not much, just a small. It's meant to for save the Japan Wartipik from local hunter, and when they give to me to about Japan Wartipik, and after the pig is held, we want to reintroduction again or release again to other remaining habitat. If they not allow release again in remaining habitat in Pangandaran, I think the best option we will give to conservation area such as Baluran National Park or Kanal Captive Breeding Center. Just a small rescue facility.
Okay. So thank you for the answers and the talk, a very interesting talk. And hopefully for the Javan Wartipik conservation in Java, and I'm sure not only so many people doing this in Java. And thank you very much for the talk, yes, and participating on this WECMIC conference. So
yes,
I think my task is finished. Throughout the 9 presenters, very distinguished guests for these sessions. And I know it's very hard to manage all the 9 talk within, let's say, not more than 3 hours. But thank you very much for your participation, your gift, and also your very nice presentations here. And I do apologize if there's any mistakes and maybe some of misspell or misunderstanding of during conveying this talk sessions. And thank you very much, and hope you have some very good message and insight, and also maybe a good lesson learned for your side. And I'm sure we are all very healthy during this COVID pandemic, and stay healthy, stay safe, and maybe it's time to boo Mary. I give the chairs to you. Thank you very much. Gracias muchas. Buenas noches.
Okay. Boo Mary? Yeah. Thank you to all of the presenters and the chair sessions for the amazing insights that we all have heard. I also would like to say thank you to all of the participants and the viewers at home. That was only the beginning of our event. After this, we have 2-hour break until 2 p.m. before we continue to our next session, which is expert talks. Look forward for the next session, and that's a wrap for the abstract presentation session. I apologize for any mistakes and conveniences that I have made. Terima kasih kepada Bapak, Ibu hadirin sekalian. Mohon maaf apabila ada kata-kata yang kurang berkenan. We'll see you after the break.
Indonesia is one of the largest archipelagic countries in the world, with more than 17,000 islands that spread over an area of more than 2 million kilometer squares. Indonesia is host to several unique ecosystems, containing a large number of diverse species. At least 10% of the world's flowering species, which counts to over 25,000 species, flourish in Indonesia. There are also 12% of the world's mammals, 16% of reptiles, 17% of birds, 6% of amphibians, and over 45% of fishes, all of which are parts of the nation/biodiversity. In order to preserve its biodiversity, which also contributes hugely to the world, Indonesia has taken significant steps in accordance to the national and global target on biodiversity framework. The government has allocated more than 500 units of protected area spread throughout the country, with the total coverage area of 22 million hectares terrestrial and 20 million marine protected area. Because of its uniqueness and universal values, 6 protected areas are recognized as World Heritage Sites, 16 Biosphere Reserves, 7 Ramsar Sites, and 7 ASEAN Heritage Sites. Many studies and researches has also been conducted to identify plants and animals to assess their potential uses for medicine, food, energy, and biocontrol for chemical hazard. Some community-driven activities such as ecotourism has also contributed to the effort to preserve Indonesia's biodiversity, which also encouraged cooperation among local stakeholders. The results are heartening. By 2019, Indonesia has been able to increase the population of endemic and priority species. Communities have also enjoyed benefits from this improved environment through ecotourism, environmental services, and other significant conditions, which contribute to their quality of life as a whole. There is little doubt that Indonesia's vast biodiversity plays a hugely significant role in reducing the impacts of climate change. By preserving its biodiversity and its ecosystems, Indonesia can help support the entire planet's sustainability and ensure a better future for all humankind.
Sejarah Fakultas Kehutanan. UGM resmi didirikan pada tanggal 19 Desember 1949 dan merupakan universitas yang bersifat nasional. Selain itu, UGM juga berperan sebagai pengemban Pancasila dan sebagai universitas pembina di Indonesia. Pada saat didirikan, UGM hanya memiliki 6 fakultas dan salah satu di antaranya adalah Fakultas Pertanian. Dalam perkembangan selanjutnya, melalui Surat Keputusan Menteri Perguruan Tinggi dan Ilmu Pengetahuan Nomor 99 tahun 1963, Fakultas Pertanian dan Kehutanan UGM terpisah menjadi 3 fakultas, yaitu Fakultas Pertanian, Fakultas Teknologi Pertanian, dan Fakultas Kehutanan. Dengan demikian, Fakultas Kehutanan UGM secara resmi dinyatakan berdiri pada tanggal 17 Agustus 1963. Dekan pertama Fakultas Kehutanan UGM adalah Profesor Insinyur Sudarwono Harjo Sudiro. Berdasarkan SK Direktur Jenderal Pendidikan Tinggi, SK Dirjen Dikti Nomor 163 tahun 2007 tentang pengaturan program studi dan surat keputusan rektor nomor 89 tahun 2010 tanggal 1 Februari 2010 mensahkan perubahan keempat program studi di Fakultas Kehutanan menjadi satu dengan nama program studi kehutanan. Program studi kehutanan terdiri dari 4 bagian, yaitu 1. Departemen Manajemen Hutan, 2. Departemen Silvikultur, 3. Departemen Teknologi Hasil Hutan, dan 4. Departemen Konservasi Sumber Daya Hutan. Di Fakultas Kehutanan terdapat Dewan Perwakilan Mahasiswa atau DPM yang berperan sebagai Badan Legislatif Mahasiswa dan Lembaga Eksekutif Mahasiswa atau LEM. Kemudian terdapat 4 himpunan mahasiswa minat, di antaranya yaitu Keluarga Mahasiswa Manajemen Hutan atau KMMH, Himpunan Mahasiswa Budidaya atau HIMABA, Family of Forest Product Technology atau Forestech, dan Family of Forest Conservation atau Forestation. Di samping itu, terdapat Badan Semi-Otonom atau BSO yang meliputi Organisasi Pencinta Alam atau Mapala Silva Gama, Komunitas Seni Kehutanan atau KSK, Keluarga Mahasiswa Islam Kehutanan atau KMIK, dan Forestry Study Club atau FSC. Sedangkan International Forestry Student Association atau IFSA dan Keluarga Mahasiswa Kristen Kehutanan atau BONITA termasuk ke dalam non-BSO.
FFI bekerja di Indonesia sejak tahun 1996, yaitu awalnya bersama dengan LIPI untuk melakukan penelitian-penelitian, terutama penelitian terkait dengan harimau Sumatera. Kemudian berkembang, kemudian kita ada kerjasama dengan Kementerian Lingkungan Hidup dan Kehutanan, waktu itu Kementerian Kehutanan, terkait dengan pengelolaan spesies-spesies yang dilindungi. Tantangan terbesarnya adalah kata kuncinya sebenarnya kepedulian. Ya, kata kuncinya adalah kepedulian. Kalau semua sudah peduli, maka secara umum sebenarnya pekerjaannya sudah done. Tapi masalahnya itu, bagaimana kita mendorong semua pihak untuk peduli menyelamatkan planet kita ini bersama-sama. Itu tantangan yang paling besar. Kearifan lokal masyarakat juga sangat penting di sana. Jadi di lain pihak kita melihat ada ancaman, tapi di lain pihak juga kita melihat ada kearifan masyarakat untuk menjaga hutannya. Nah, itu yang kita coba untuk dorong untuk dikembangkan. Planet kita ini yang sustain, sustaining the planet, itu jangka panjang paling panjang kita. Jadi itu tujuan jangka panjang keberadaan FFI. Bukan hanya di Indonesia, tapi di dunia.